Tell the truth. Tell the truth. Tell the truth.
Ladies and gentlemen, thank you for your patience. I'm about to go live in just a moment, but I want everybody to definitely get a lot out of this today. I am going to do sort of a different show or similar show, but I have other topics that I'm going to talk about that I'm going to bring up today, along with this particular topic about Mason, Tennessee. It seems that when black people are trying to build something, trying to build their society, their town, their culture, someone is always trying to mess with us. We saw it in Tulsa, Oklahoma. Black people had a thriving community. They did everything they could to undermine that community and destroy that community. We witnessed these things with Rosewood and what they did to destroy that community. In many other black communities, there was a Black Wall Street actually in North Carolina that they destroyed when black people are minding their own business. In this case, you have a town, Mason, Tennessee, that they are trying to take the town's charter. Do you understand what I'm saying to you? Claiming that the town has been fiscally irresponsible over the years, even though I'm going to get to that in just a moment, letting you know why the town has had some economic issues. But this is a damn shame. This is the sort of stuff that goes on in America. So with that said, peace to everybody. Thank you for being here. Let's get started.
Tell the truth.
We'll be right back.
truth. Tell the truth. Tell the truth. Tell the truth.
What's up, everybody? Peace. What's up, everybody?
Tell the truth.
All right, everybody. Thank you. Thank you, everybody. Thank you for your patience. I have a few things. I'm going to do this like a variety show. I'm going to be talking about a variety of different topics, but this is the first. I'm doing something a little different with this broadcast today. I'll be talking about the first topic at hand, which is what's happening in Mason, Tennessee, a thriving black town, in terms of the fact that it was once a town that was dominated by white society. They decided to leave the town, and now that the town has struggled over the years fiscally, guess what? It was not put in this fiscal situation because it was black people alone that did this. As I said before, the town once had a lot of white people. They ghosted the town. And when they were in charge, they put this town in the economic problems that they are. So you have a situation in which black people make up the majority of this town in Mason, Tennessee. Look it up. 1,500 black people make up the total population in terms of black people in this town. They are the majority. They run the city government, but they have been cleaning up mess that was created before they were even in charge of this town. And so What's happening, ladies and gentlemen? I want to say thank you to everybody out there who's watching, who's coming through. I don't know what the numbers are going to be today because simply these are the type of subject matters that we should be focusing on instead of fighting each other, one another, talking about one another on YouTube, disrespecting one another. We do more against each other than we do against our true enemy. Here you have a black town that's been minding their business. Nobody gave a damn. Into now. What's happening now? Before I go to the chat room and greet some folks that are coming in, let's go over to Exhibit A. Let me put this on the screen like so. Right here, this is the town, Mason, Tennessee, established in 1855. If I'm correct, we got Richard Land Hill Park, West Tennessee. This is in the western part of Tennessee. Mason Golf World Famous Fried Chicken. Okay. So this is sort of the map design of this beautiful place. But this is the situation. This is what's happening. You've got Blue Avery City coming to this town. This is actually an actual city that they're creating that will be run by Ford. Ford has created an electric truck plant, power plant for electric vehicles, because electric power is the future. By the way, San Francisco, where I lived at for many years, ladies and gentlemen, they're already experimenting. Not only experimenting, they already have vehicles that are being driven by themselves, taxis that are being driven by themselves in San Francisco as we speak, because that's the area where technology is in Silicon Valley. I lived there for so many years, and you can get in a cab and ride in that cab without a person driving. You can, just like an Uber, you can order the cab to come pick you up, drop you off. And I'm actually signing up to have my first taste at what the future holds. And so I will definitely get that on the YouTube channel, let you all see the experience. But this is what this Blue Ivory City is doing. They're trying to create something for the future, and that future is now. And this is based on Ford, even though they want to make you think that it was the Ford Model T that was the first car that was built. Actually, and I'm going to be bringing this up very soon. Actually, it was two black men who actually had the idea and the original design for a car. And as you know, in this society, it always gets stolen.
Tell the truth.
Our ideas get stolen from us, or we don't get the patent for that. So I'm going to bring that up. That's history. It was two black men that were the original, had the original idea, mindset and design for a car concept. So, Ford coming out with their Model T at that time, cornering the market with a stolen design, ladies and gentlemen, they are the ones behind the Blue Ivory City. This city is very close to, only a few miles away from Mason, Tennessee. Okay. And who lives in Mason, Tennessee? Let me show you these pictures right now. Black people, 15. Black people, 1,500. Here's some more pictures. Black folks, they're in church. The reason why you see them in here with their faces looking very disappointed is because they're in church. They're holding a meeting because they've been given an ultimatum by the state controller, played by this individual right here, the usual white supremacist.
Tell the truth.
That's Powell's trying to take over. That's Manson Powell's, Jason Munson Powell's, whatever the hell you want to call him. He's the usual suspect. Whenever black people, as Nellie Fuller Jr. said, whatever's happening to black people, that's a negative, that's bad, that's a mess with. The white supremacist is always there. The white supremacist is always surely there. This man is behind all the bullshit. Let me let you hear immediately, folks, and I'm going to definitely acknowledge people in the chat room, but just give me a little bit of time. This is part of the presentation because this is very important. This is very important. And I am going to call for a vote very soon to see how many of you even heard of this particular case, ladies and gentlemen. But let me let you hear from the usual white supremacists.
Tell the truth.
Because they're playing games here. The bottom line, ladies and gentlemen, is that they weren't concerned about this black town and how they were fiscally irresponsible for the last 20 years, as you're going to hear him say. They weren't concerned about their economic, what they were doing with their town charter until old Ford comes into town and has a plan to build a big giant campus, a big giant plant, which is going to bring money, honey, money. And it would be Mason, Tennessee that would stand the biggest chance to win at this. But let's listen to the usual suspect.
4 miles from where the Ford plant's going to be, that's potentially going to lose their charter. How does that get justified, and what is the situation with the finances specifically?
20 years of poor financial management in Mason. What we're trying to do is help them get on track so that they can benefit from all the development that's coming to their area.
And why is this becoming a situation now?
It's been a situation for 20 years.
Right, but why are you leaning on them now?
Well, it's just become
So there it is, folks. I'm going to stop it right there. I'm going to let this play itself out again. Let's hear this again.
What is the situation with the finances specifically?
20 years of poor financial management in Mason. What we're trying to do is help them get on track so that they can benefit from all the development that's coming to their area.
And yeah, right.
Why is this becoming a situation now?
It's been a situation for 20 years.
Right, but why are you leaning on them now?
Well, it's just become untenable, and they've never had an opportunity to. Tax-paying citizens have never had an opportunity like they do now.
It's for their own good?
It's for the good of the tax-paying citizens who are getting nothing for the taxes they're paying.
What does that mean, getting nothing?
Well, they're getting no services. So when the mayor of a city can't articulate what benefit the taxpayers are receiving from being a city, then it's time to evaluate whether they need to continue to be a city.
The timing of it that you're now starting to pressure them right when Ford shows up, it starts to look a little more than coincidental. So I'm wondering why suddenly are you taking an interest in Mason?
Because if Mason doesn't get their finances in order, the opportunity for development is going to bypass them.
The opportunity for
development. So all of a sudden.
The opportunity for the opportunity for neighborhoods.
So ladies and gentlemen, so all of a sudden they're so concerned about a black town made up of 1,500 black people. They're so concerned in the neighboring town that is part of this, which this man comes from, the usual suspect, ladies and gentlemen, in the perpetrator upon our people, historically. All of a sudden, they're concerned about black people in this little town called Mason, Tennessee, made up of 1,500 black folks. They're so concerned about their fiscal responsibility. This is from a town called, Tipperlon, the neighboring town, which is an all-white Republican town, And by the way, for those of you out there on YouTube who like to tout how great the Republicans are, when both the Democrats, the Democrats screw you with Vaseline and the Republicans screw you without Vaseline. Guess what? They just had a report that came out not too long ago that said that the majority of the, Republicans always say that the most violence is happening in urban cities like New York, Chicago. They always talking about Chicago. Ain't that right, Brother Rob? I see you in the chat room. They're always messing with Chicago. Yeah, Chicago's got its issues. New York's got its issues. LA's got its issue. Major cities have their issues. But guess what? In a recent report, they found out the majority, a high number of the Southern Republican-ran states are actually leading in crime. Matter of fact, everybody thinks Chicago is leading, and Chicago is not even the leading state when it comes to crime overall. It's a lot of these Southern states that nobody talks about. Like Tennessee, you hear his Southern drawl here. Let's hear more of the usual suspect.
To develop. You know, Mason doesn't have a grocery store or a gas station. and the citizens suffer from not having the ability.
So now they're all of a sudden, it's been 20 years, as he said, of poor management fiscally. And he wants to tell you that, well, poor Mason, a black town, doesn't have a grocery store. They don't have this. Well, what happened to the last 20 years? Why weren't you all concerned about this town in the mayor in this town? This is the city hall of this town. It's a town, folks. It's not a city. It's a town. So towns have small little places like this. But they weren't concerned about this little town. But all of a sudden now, they're so concerned about this little town with this little mayor's building and what have you. Now, why? Because the Ford plant is coming. And Mason, he talks about them being not having fiscal money to run their city. No, they're concerned that if the town of Mason will benefit from all economic gain, jobs, as well as economic development to restore their town because of the economic boom that the Ford plant will bring, and that they will actually benefit the most over the white towns or the towns that have a white majority like Tipperton, who's trying to take them over. And then the state has got in on the act. Where's Joe Biden, who said that he was for black people? Huh? Where is Joe Biden to step in and say, leave the black town alone? Black people voted for this administration, 93% women, 83% black men. Where is the Biden administration to step in and stop what they're doing in Tennessee? The state trying to take the town over, trying to tell them to give up their 153-year-old charter that they own. We got a so-called black vice president in office. Where is her statement about what's happening? We haven't heard a damn thing. It's a damn shame. Makes you wonder. You have to laugh to keep from crying. Let's hear more from the usual suspect.
Because if Mason doesn't get their finances in order, the opportunity for development is going to bypass them. The opportunity for neighborhoods to develop. You know, Mason doesn't have a grocery store or a gas station, and the citizens suffer from not having the ability to have those things in their community.
Oh, you're so concerned about it now.
In order, just as we have done with other communities across the state, the comptroller will have to run their finances for a while.
What other communities does that happen to?
Jellicoe, Van Buren County, to name a couple. We make a decision about their expenditures.
I want to run something back here. Because when he said that, I want to tell you what happened here. Let me stop it right there. Okay. The place that he was talking about called Jellicoe. Former city recorded stolen nearly 1,000 from Jellicoe. The controller, former city recorder, stole nearly 1,000 from Jericho. This was a white woman that stole money, 100,000, from a city called Jericho. And she was the former recorder who stole. This was a white woman. Go deal with that city. Leave this city alone. Leave these black folks alone. That's what I have to say about this. So I just want y'all to hear. I wanted y'all to hear that and all the nonsense that goes on with it. So the bottom line is they weren't concerned about this town until this town struck gold with a company, the Ford company, that's going to build an electric truck power plant in this community, which the people in this community would desperately boom. If he's saying that, well, they wouldn't have their roads developed, they wouldn't have their town developed. No, they don't need you to develop it, sucker. They would get the economic boom from the Ford company. You simply want to take them over and absorb them into the town called Tipperland, which is made up of mostly white people, because this is a smash and grab, ladies and gentlemen. This is what this is called. It's called a smash and grab. And I want to thank, I got a super chat earlier, and I'm going to see if I could find a sister super chat that she sent me. This is from Speak With Your Girl, Marcella. Thank you for the $20 super chat, my sister. I appreciate that. I'm going to give you a clap.
Thank you for the super chat.
She says, come on and hit the like button for everybody. Thank you, sister. I appreciate that. I really appreciate you giving me support like that. I really appreciate that. That's a great super chat to start off the show with. And with that said, I'll do a shortcut to my super chat celebration. Here we go.
Time to run it off. I wake up. Yeah. I wake up. Flex, I'm down that. Check. No drip this.
Wet. Tell
the truth. No sleep, no rest. Might crash, might wreck. But first I
stretch.
Time to run it all. I wake up.
Flex.
Thumb down that.
Check.
No drip this.
Whack.
Time to run it all. No sleep, no
rest.
Might crash, might
wreck.
But first I
stretch.
Time to run it all.
Out of 10, rub through my hands, I'm by my lonely. Turn to a savage, now my thank baby you wants to hold me. I love my fans, don't need no friends, I got my homies. Thought I could trust you, I find out you tried to zone me. I'm number one up on that court, I'm Nick McGrady. The first one in, the last one out, can't call me lazy. Put in my...
All right, everybody, thank you once more. Let me go into the chat room, greet a few people here. See who we got here. We got Sister Erica, Carolina is in the house, Back to the Basics, Pretora, Afro. All right, we got my man, the Hawk, in the house here, coming through strong and giving great support, which I appreciate. Let me take something off of here at the bottom. There we go. Come back in here. Back to the Basics is in the house. Let me see who else. We got TMBM in the house. Thank you. We got a brother Keith who's giving me a beautiful super chat. He says, my good brother Information Man Show. Hope I'm not too late, but I'm here to spread the love, my dear brother. And
thank you.
I want to say thank you for that super chat. Keep doing your thing and subscribe to the Info Media channel. Yeah, make sure you subscribe to the Info Media channel. It will benefit you, particularly if you are someone who's thinking about creating a YouTube channel or you have a YouTube channel already. I'm going to give you some insights, some tips, and I'm going to give it to you from a down to earth, around the corner, down the block and down the street, YouTube street type of way. So I hope that you all will go over there and subscribe to that channel. I do have it pinned up to the top of the chat room. Subscribe. I want those numbers to go up in subscribership because I'm going to be posting videos Monday, Thursday through Friday. It just depends, 2 times a week or more, because it's a brand new channel and I have to build that channel up. But I really appreciate the super chat, my brother. So thank you again. A clap to you. Appreciate that, brother Keith. Weston, thank you, brother. You a great supporter there, as everyone in the chat room are great supporters. We've got Queen, I Know I Am. Thank you for being here. We've got Lady Leg 75. I've got a treat for you next week, too. I just got to give you all a heads up. I got a treat for you next week. I've got some brothers coming on. Man, we're going to get into health, ladies' health, men's health. These brothers are going to be dynamic. They're going to blow you right out of your chair, your seat, wherever you are. They're going to be on with me next Sunday. So next Sunday, I got an interview. I'm interviewing a brother here, two brothers. They got a dynamic channel. And I think the information that they're going to lay on you is exactly what this channel is all really all about. It's a solution. It's about what we can provide you information that can be a difference in your life. We got Lady Leg 75. Thank you for coming here. We got called in. Richmond, thank you, brother. Thank you, Calden. I thank you for being here. Rich Hart, thank you for being here, brother. I appreciate the everyone who's coming over. All right. Angelicia, what's going on, sister? Thank you. Angelica, my sister Angelica. Good to see you over here. Thank you for the support, everybody. We got a good crowd that's come out tonight. Come out this evening, wherever you are in the world. Angelica, thank you. She says, hey, good people, sorry I'm late. Hey, it's no problem. It's no problem, sister. You here, you're alive, you're thriving. I only appreciate that. Queen of Noam saying, gift can be sent here to our beloved. Thank you. Thank you. And it goes right back into the show. But I want everybody, we got good numbers already, people coming in, but you got to get over here next Sunday, because these brothers, for the ladies out there that are in the chat room, these brothers are going to be giving you some very good health tips as it relates to things that you should not be using, products that we should not be putting on our body that's putting chemicals in our body. We're going to have tips for men, what men need to watch out for. These brothers are the real deal. Okay. Cleansing of your body, holistic health measures. These brothers are the real deal. The doctor is the real deal. I can't wait until they come on. We got Catherine with friends who's coming to the house. Clap to you. Highly Flavored is in the house. Thank you. And let me see. We got Voltron, Black Voltron's in the house. I like when y'all got easy names to pronounce. It just makes it flow. Erica, let me see. Thank you for putting the information in there for the other channel. Whether it be the podcast channel or the info media channel, you know, thank you for taking the time to put those in there, because I really appreciate that. And now we got a variant perspective in the house saying, what's up, information man, saying keep that fire going. Thank you, brother. Thank you. All right. Angelica, so good to see you over here, sister, again. And everyone, let me just go ahead and do this right here. Let everybody be aware of this. So once again, let me just go over this. I got a lesson planned for you. Let's just go over step by step before we get into the other issues. And let's go from top down. I'm going to read this to you. Mason, Tennessee, the majority black town of about 1,500 people, located within 5 miles of the future site of Blue Ivy City, the Ford electric truck and battery plant. North Carolina. Now, this is one I'm going to talk about. I'm not going to get to that yet. Excuse me there. Mason electric elected officials who have been fighting to maintain control over their town since Manpower issued an ultimatum, which you heard his voice, the usual suspect. Either surrender control of Mason's 153-year-old charter or face a financial takeover. The state is involved in this as well as the county. How can they do this? Because they see the money, baby. They don't care about the town. They don't care about the black people in this town. They simply want the money. They simply want to take over the situation. This is greed. They're saying they want them to relinquish its charter, would have placed the majority black, majority Democratic town under control of a largely white, as I said before, and Republican led Tipton County. A financial takeover, ladies and gentlemen, will give the controller veto power over every expense of $100 or more, limiting the authority of the elected officials to embark on plans to improve the infrastructure. So if this town, Mason, Tennessee, made up of 1,500 black people who are the majority of the town, who are in leadership of this town, if they decide on their own, because they got the charter, that they want to rebuild their city, they want to make this a thriving city, they can't do it if their charter is taken away from them. They'll have to answer to this majority white town, Tipperton County. Or to the county Tipperton. So once again, it will be them. Once again, it will be, in this case, white folks telling black folks what to do. How, when to jump, when to walk, and how high to jump. Tell the truth.
Tell the truth.
Mason, which occupies fewer than 2 square miles, lies just 4.5 miles from the newly planned interstate, So now there's an interstate because of this Blue Ivy City Ford electric power plant coming for trucks. Interstate 40 off ramp that will bring, if any of you are from Tennessee or been to Tennessee and you know about the Interstate 40 off ramp, that will bring interstate traffic directly to Blue Ivy City, which will be a direct benefit. Because think about it, if people are driving to go to work there, people are driving because of this particular plant, that means people are going to stop off in places like Mason, Tennessee and spend money. Spend money at the restaurant, spend money at their hotel, spend money in their stores. And even if they don't have a grocery store now, the boom of this plant could make it possible for the city to build their, to put a town, not a city, a town to build their own grocery store if they don't have one. And by turning over their charter of 153 years to Tipperland County, you put the power in the destiny. Black people put the power in their destiny.
Tell the truth.
Not in the hands of black people who make up the town, but in the hands of white people. Ask yourself, what white-owned town in America has put the destiny of their town in the hands of a white, of a black neighboring town? Would it be possible if the roles were reversed, if Mason had the power and this plant was coming to Tipperland County and Mason said, nah, we can't let the white folks have that kind of power, that kind of economic growth. We're going to take over your charter. You know, it would never happen, ladies and gentlemen. It would never happen. Let's take a vote in the chat room right now. I want to know how many people in the chat room are aware, heard of this story. If you heard of this story of Mason, Tennessee being taken over by the neighboring town of Tipperland County, and the state is now gotten involved in this horrendous theft. I want you to tell me if you heard about this story. Put a one in the chat room if you heard of this story. Put a two in the chat room if you have not heard this story before. Truth. Let's see what the votes are right now. Put a one if you were already aware of this situation. Put a two in the chat room if you were not aware of this situation. While we're bullshitting around on YouTube, arguing, spending hours on panels, talking about one another, we've got black communities being under siege by the states in this country and the local municipalities in this country. We got a White House right now where we got a Democratic president who claimed he was in the best interest of black folks, with a vice president who's supposed to be black. And I haven't heard anything come out of that White House to stop it. Now, I know you say, well, you know, the federal government shouldn't interfere in local government, local politics. But here is a black town being railroaded. Joe Biden himself went to Tulsa, Oklahoma, gave all that speech. You had Miss Fletcher, who's 100-some years old, never gave her any reparations. Everybody was surrounding the president, clapping for him. He went down and gave that speech. Here we got a town, a black town, that's about to get engulfed and taken over because of the economics of a Ford company coming in. And you haven't heard anything from the. How many of you knew about this situation? So let's see. Carolina Harvey knew about it. Miss Taylor puts a two. She didn't know about it. Awakened black heterosexual didn't know about it. Bonnie Rose didn't know about it. Jackie didn't know about it. B1 Beauty Supply knows about it. Highly Favorite knows about it. Okay. We got quite a few people went in here that didn't know about it, though, ladies and gentlemen. That's why I try to do what I try to do. We've got Man Making Four didn't know about it. And I know Queen, I know I am. I know that the Elder, and I will be bringing the Elder. Oh, shit, I should have brought the Elder over here today. Maybe I'll send the Elder a link and get him on the panel and get his perspective on this. Because I know the Elder talked about this on his channel. He's got a big channel over there. He's got a lot of heavy support. And I really appreciate the Elder because he talked about this. And maybe I'll send him a link see if he wants to jump on board and talk to me about this today. I'll probably drop a link for other people to talk about this as well. We got King Wage, who's just come in the house saying Black Voltron. King Wage, thank you, brother. King Wage, were you aware of this situation that I'm bringing up today, brother? Put a one if you are, two if you didn't. We've got Natural, who's in the house, who puts a two. She wasn't aware of this. Of course, Queen, I know you were aware of this because you were rocking with the great one himself, and that is the elder. I got him on speed dial, matter of fact. And then we got my man Kujan 87, who says one, that he was aware of it. And Keith Weston, I've heard about this story from Tim Black. Yeah, I know Tim Black be on top of it. I know he be on top of it. And let me go back down here. We got my man, the Hawk, who put the one. There you go. Look at that. The Hawk right there, who said one, that he knew about it. And I'm not surprised. I'm not surprised at all. Some of you in the chat room are very well informed, very well read. Let me see. Carolina Harvey says, I understand back to the basics. I was tripping against myself when I was only 30 years old. Okay, they're having conversation in there. Very good. And let me see. So we got quite a few people who are aware of this. Lions Den, stick around because I know you lived in Tennessee or you live in Tennessee. I don't know if you're still in New Mexico. Stick around, brother. I can send you a link if you want to come on board the panel to talk about this. Anybody who wants to come up and talk about this. And we got Carlton, because I know you are in Tennessee, brother, so I want to get your perspective on this, Lion's Den. So don't go nowhere. Carlton said number two, he didn't know about it. And this is why we're here to do this, folks. Okay? This is why we're here to do this. What's going on? Successful and Excellence is in the house. Thank you for being here. Successful Excellence, greetings and what's up? Subscribe to the channel if you have not. And matter of fact, ladies and gentlemen, I should have those, the info media channel, I should have those numbers up. There's no excuse if you have not subscribed to that channel, and then you can jump right back over here with me. Go ahead and do it, or just write the name down, Info Media Live in high capital letters. And then you can go check it out whenever you have time if you don't want to miss anything right now. We got Super Mike 2164. Super Mike, let me know if you heard about this story. Were you aware of a town called Mason, Tennessee? They have a charter of 153 years. There is a Blue Ivy City plant being built there by Ford, which is going to boom the whole area. And they stand to make the most economically out of this. You have a neighboring county called Tipton County that's trying to absorb them into their county so that they can get the main benefits of the plant economically. They don't want to see this black town thrive. So now all of a sudden, after all these years have passed and they weren't thinking about this town, all of a sudden, the usual suspect right here, let me put it to you, the usual suspect right here, who is the controller, he's trying to come in and take the town away from them by saying, we're giving you an ultimatum. If you don't do this the way we want you to do it, damn it, we're taking it away from you. It's a damn shame. And that's just the damn truth. That's just the damn truth. Let me show you the video. Let's stop playing around here. Let me show you the first video. Let's stop playing around here. I appreciate everybody in that chat room. You can tell I'm pissed off about this whole thing. Let's go here with the first video. And y'all know how I do it over here. Here we go.
After months of back and forth between the city of Mason and the state's comptroller, a resolution could be coming.
It hurt us, you know, and I am saddened by the fact of how they're doing it.
A spokesperson with the Tennessee Comptroller Office tells WREG they intend to take over Mason's financial operations by the end of the week. This decision comes after they urge Mason to give up its charter and become a part of Tipton County government. City leaders declined, so now their finances will be managed by the state.
with them coming in to take over the finances, as I stated earlier, it can cause a hindrance to us for us moving business.
Tennessee's comptroller came to this decision after they say they uncovered years of money mismanagement.
Opportunity will pass it by because outside companies, outside groups aren't going to want to invest in a community where they know there's the history of mismanagement.
Mason sits close to where Ford's Blue Oval City will be built. For local resident Richard Mulberry, who owns several properties in the city, he supports the state's decision and hope it leads to change.
If the county took over, they would at least take care of the streets, you know. Our taxes wouldn't be as high. We wouldn't be paying out all that we're paying here. But nothing in return. What are we getting in return?
Over the years, city leaders say they have made improvements to its finances. Despite the state stepping in, Rivers say this is far from over.
If we have been here all this time, we can still thrive in Mason. And regardless of how we look now, doesn't mean that's how the outcome going to be. But we got to stand together.
Reporting in Mason, Jordan James, WREG, News Channel 3.
By the way, the town of Mason plans to send a letter to the Tennessee Comptroller, hoping both sides can meet soon. More information from the Comptroller is expected to be released sometime this week.
Tell the truth. Tell the truth.
All right, so what you can see right there with the first video, they're trying to take it over. They're saying that there was fiscal responsibility was not handled correctly. And let me go back to this one point right here that I was bringing up earlier. There's this major highway, as I said before, the Interstate 40, the Highway 79, which leaks the Blue Oval to the Memphis Run right past Mason Small Central District. And the CSX, the Cow Railroad, runs directly through the town. The railroad runs directly through the town on a route that will take it straight to the Blue Oval campus. So right now, Mason as a town is sitting on a gold mine. But now, check this out. If Tipperland takes them over, which is going to be run primarily by white people, what say will this black town have in their own destiny? And this is about trying to, this is a money grab and a land grab. This is about land grabbing and controlling the land in which black people live on. This is the way, this is about taking their destiny away from them, taking their independence away from them. And as the sister said, look, do they have problems there? Yes, they're trying to work through their problems, but we don't need them taking them over all of a sudden because they see the money. Follow the money. The money is the plant. If the plant was not built there, how many of you in the chat room by show of putting a one? Let me just say this. If this plant wasn't being built near Mason, Tennessee, what Tipperland County or the state of Tennessee give a damn about Mason, Tennessee, a black town? I argue that they would not. If you believe that they would not give a damn about them, if it was not for this new economic boom getting ready to come there, put a one in the chat room. If you're not sure, put a two. I argue that they wouldn't give a damn. Mason, Tennessee would still be in the predicament that they're claiming that it's in, and they wouldn't care. They are seizing on an opportunity to take over because they smell money. Follow the money, and you will follow all the bullshit. And that's the truth.
Tell the truth.
Let's see what you're saying in the chat room. Everyone is agreeing with me. Lionsden is agreeing with me. Black Voltron. We got RP putting on in there. We got Awakened Black Heterosexual. Dunn Rose is in the house. Various perspective is saying yes. Thank you. Everybody is on point in this chat room. Super Mike is on point. Everybody is on point, ladies and gentlemen, in this chat room. All of you. Clap to you all. You're all on point. Now, Manpower, which I showed you a few minutes ago, the usual suspect that's always messing with us when we're minding our own damn business. Black folks in Mason, Tennessee, they weren't bothering nobody. All of a sudden now, they're being given ultimatums. Ultimatums. I can't even say it, ladies and gentlemen. Manpower has pointed to 20 years history of financial mismanagement by the town leaders that has left it with deep debt and crumbling infrastructure. Guess what? They have debt and crumbling infrastructure because at one time it was white people that were in control of this town. And when they decided, when they got ran out because they were corrupt, when they got ran out and when they ran them, when they left this town that was becoming more majority black. They were left holding the bag in a bad economic situation that was caused by people who were in leadership who didn't even look like them. Now, in that video that I showed you, you saw the one white guy who was saying, well, I think it would be good because we got to know where our tax money is going and we need to get our infrastructure fixed. Of course, he's going to go with his tribe. Of course, he's going to go with those that he has most in common with. That's just truth.
Tell the truth.
Mason leaders, he said, are ill prepared. That's what the usual suspect said that I just played that video, that audio for you. He said, prepared to take advantage of the growth of a new investment to come from Blue Oval City. Now, how would he know that? Wouldn't the investment of that power plant benefit the city because now they would see revenue coming in because of a highway that would boom the city with people stopping off there to buy products? How would he know that it would that they're not prepared for it? How does he not know that they need that to reject themselves to where they need to be? Hallelujah.
Tell the truth.
Let me read this last bit of the lesson plan. This is a akin to a hostile takeover. The state officials asked residents of a small, predominantly black town near the site of the new Ford investment to forfeit their charter of 153 years, ladies and gentlemen.
Tell the truth.
Or face a takeover. This is how generational wealth is stopped. This is how generational wealth is destroyed. This is how black people have things taken from us. We get redlined. They put freeways through our community. They put all sorts of disruptions into our communities to mess us up. They either, if they can't destroy us physically, then they'll come up with slick ways in the law to mess with black towns. So I got to ask black folks today who are listening, those of us on the YouTube streets, why are we sitting up here on the YouTube streets fighting each other when we have a bigger enemy that's trying to destroy towns like Mason, Tennessee, where black people were minding their own damn business? Why are you not fighting that? Huh? Why are you not fighting the real enemy? Why are you fighting people that look like you? Why are black men talking about black women like a dog? Why are black women on YouTube talking about black men like a dog too? Why? Why don't you talk about,
tell the truth,
and face the real enemies? The real, as Muhammad Ali said, you're my opposer when I want freedom, justice, and equality. You're my opposer. Why should I go to Vietnam and fight for a country that won't fight for me at home? You're my opposer. Why are we fighting each other on YouTube when we have real opposers messing with people that look just like us in our communities, whether it be urban communities or townships? I want you to look at yourself in the mirror and say, what are you doing on YouTube arguing? And I've argued with people myself. I'm not going to deny that, but I'm sick of it. What are we doing more than arguing with each other, sitting on panels for an hour, when we got real stuff happening outside of YouTube? We got a black town that was minding its own business. They're being engulfed here. We should be bringing this awareness to our people, not nonsense about gender wars. You're feeding right into the enemy's plan for you. It's called divide and conquer. Have us fight each other. Pit us against one another. While we're pitting against one another, we have no economic growth. We have no generational wealth being created. And we've got black towns and cities and communities being taken over. And we ain't got no ability to do a damn thing about it. Because we spend too much time arguing with each other. Meanwhile, our legacies and generational wealth, as I said before, and towns that have our stamp on it are being taken away at any given moment, because now you have a white town trying to engulf a black town. And another thing, too, this does play into politics. Mason, Tennessee is a Democratic town. Black people are Democratic there. Tipton County is made up of mostly white Republicans. So that's another way to play this voter suppression game, while engulfing the black town that's Democratic into a mostly majority white town of white people who are Republicans. Now you can dilute the vote. And I'm not saying that Democrats are any damn good or the Democrats are any good and the Republican clan isn't any good. But you see, that's another way to dilute the vote in the favor of the Republican clan. Even though we're still not getting a damn thing from the Democrats.
They call me Mr. Tibbs.
They call me Mr. Tibbs. Here you have a black town. This black town needs more black men and black women to stand up and do what Sidney Poitier did. Now stand up and say, they call me.
They call me Mr. Tibbs.
Stand up, put your foot down, say, nah, we're not going to allow you to do this. Where are the, we need black leadership. The Farrakhan, I hope Farrakhan, if he's out there listening to me, when we talk about black towns, we got leadership like Farrakhan. We got so-called people that think they're leaders like Al Sharpton's, all these black civil rights leaders who run around. Where are they at? They should be down there in that town using all their legal lawyer, right? I think with NAACP, they should be involved in this heavily if they're not already, if they even got any goddamn juice. This should not be allowed to happen. This is only happening because they want the money that the town is going to be able to gross out of this deal. This is all this is about, a money grab. And a land grab that they can manipulate by saying, okay, we're going to take this town and make it part of Tipton County. That's a land grab because of how close they are to the plant that's coming. This is all a damn shame. Let me play some more of this for you. Another video, shall we?
This power.
This gives the story, but you're going to hear a little bit more from the vice mayor in this one. So it will repeat a few things from the other video, but not a lot. But you're going to hear more from the vice mayor and how she feels about this. A little bit more detail from her. Here we go.
In less than an hour, elected officials in Mason, Tennessee will hold a public meeting to discuss the town's future, which hangs in the balance. Now, we've been telling you how the Tennessee Comptroller has urged Mason to either relinquish its charter to the state or allow itself to be folded into the Tipton County government. As WRG's Alice Coleman reports, Mason's vice mayor is determined to keep the town's charter in spite of the pressure from the state capitol.
Giving up our charter is just like, to me, giving up our charter is like just walking away and saying, forget it.
Virginia Rivers, Mason's vice mayor, is even more adamant about not relinquishing the town's charter after a letter from Tennessee Comptroller Jason Mumpower showed up in mailboxes.
To try to encourage them, in a sense, to go against their leaders, it's really to divide our city, if you really look at it.
Mumpower's letter opens bluntly with, in my opinion, it's time for Mason to relinquish his charter. He went on to write, unfortunately, government is not working in Mason. Mumpower pointed out the major loss of jobs after the West Tennessee detention facility closed and said people and companies will not invest their money in a poorly run town. River says the town is taking steps to improve its financial hardships.
We have located us a city manager. We do have an attorney. We have that. We also have a planner. So those are three of the main things that Mason was in need of that they now have.
Okay, I'll give it to you.
But Mason's problems were news to Memphis businessman Bob Peltz.
Well, I did not know that.
Peltz happened to be in Mason Thursday looking to buy 20 to 25 acres of land.
I'm looking for a spot to do an RV park. I've done several of them in the past years, and I thought this would be a great opportunity for me.
Peltz was inquiring about the availability of utilities for his proposed RV park and future growth in the area.
They're pretty close to the new Ford plant. That's why I'm here today.
Alex Coleman, WREG-TV, News Channel 3.
Okay, everybody. Angelica, I read what you were saying. This is what I pulled up. Okay, the economic, then zip. This is the Mason, Tennessee. Let me read this right over here. Let me see. Unemployment rate is about 5.2%. The United States average is about 6.0%. This is Mason, Tennessee. Their zip code is 38049, if you all want to know that. It has a job market that has increased by 2.1% over the last year. Future job growth over the next 10 years is predicted to be 36.2%, which is higher than the United States average. You know why? Because the damn Ford plant is coming. They projected this. The Ford plant is going to bring jobs. It's going to bring growth that's going to benefit the town. And this is why they want this town to be taken over by Tipton County. This is a land grab and an economic grab on black folks in America. At this time, this ain't the 1950s. This ain't the 1940s, 1920s. This is right now in the 21st century, the year 2022. And that is the damn truth.
Tell the truth.
And I want to say thank you again for the super chat. Brother Keith Weston gave me a super chat. He says, we need all ADOS, FBA, RBG, Pan-African, Aborigine. We need all these tribes to come together, stop the divide, and raise up together. I would say a clap to that. I would say a clap to that. Let me go on and read some more of this data here because Angelica, you brought up a very good point here. Check this out. Tax rates for Mason. The sales tax rates for Mason is 9.3%. The United States average is 7.3%. The income tax rate for Mason is about 0.0%. The United States average is 4.6%. The tax rates can have a big impact when compared to cost of living. Income and salaries for Mason residents, the average, I would imagine that they're not making a lot of money in this town, but let's just read here. The average income of Mason residents is about $19,463 a year. That's the average amount of money that the citizens in this town of 1,500 black people are making a year. The United States average is about $28,555 a year. So they're not making a lot of money in Mason, but imagine what that new plant is going to boom for them. Okay? The median household income of Mason residents is about $32,080 a year. The United States average is about $53,482 a year, ladies and gentlemen. Tell the truth.
Tell the truth.
Okay. So right here, I got a little chart right here. It's got Mason, Tennessee. It's got Memphis metro area. It's got Tennessee state. Check this out. The under 15 people that are making money. Let me see this. This is, let me see. What do I want to do with this chart? What is this chart telling me? income by population percentages. This is income by population percentages. So the income by population percentages for Mason is 15.3%, whereas for Memphis metro area is 14.1%. Okay? Let me see. This is the percent. This is the percentages. The under, that was the under percentages that I just read to you. The over percentages is about 1.6% for Mason residents and about 4.4% for metro Tennessee residents. That's over 2,000. So the bottom line is, check this out. Unemployment rates. As I read before, unemployment is 5.2%. Recent job growth is minus 5.8%. Future job growth is at 36.2%, as I said before. Sales tax is 9.3%. I'm giving you the damn information. 9.3% is the sales tax. The income tax is 0.0, folks. No income tax, right? The income per capita is $21,966 compared to $31,177 in the United States overall. That's income per capita. Household income is $45,650 in Mason, Tennessee. Okay. Compared to $57,652 across the country. Family medium income is $53,640. While that family medium income is $70,850 in America across the board. I want to stop right there because I don't want to bore you with all the numbers, but I just want to give you the information.
Tell the truth.
Because I think the question that Angelica asked was a legitimate question. What's going on, Tiffany Jackson? Thank you for being here. King Wage, everybody. I think Boo made a good question, made a good statement in here. There was a sister in here who left a good. What's going on, Big Dog Philly OG? We got Ann in the house. They're saying that someone left a message in here. I think it was Boo who said that, wait a minute, there's a whole bunch of towns and places in America that have fallen on hard times fiscally, that have had some things happen to them fiscally. Why are we just focusing on this town? Right. I have to agree with you.
Tell the truth.
And thank you for the super chats. If I miss any super chats, I want to say thank you again. Thank you again. Thank you again. I really appreciate that. Really appreciate that. I got to give you all a clap for being here. We got 95 people watching so far in the watch box. Do me the biggest favor and share this video in all of your social media. If you got a cell phone right now, you can share it to Twitter, to Facebook, all that good stuff. Share it, share it, share it in any type of medium that you have because people need to hear this presentation. Now we've got right here, we got Muhammad saying integration was the worst thing that happened to blacks. It's unfortunate that Martin Luther King did not realize that until the end of his life. Now, I would agree with you that integration has not worked out for black people economically because we lost all of our businesses. But in this case, this is a situation, my dear brother. This is our sister. This is my case to you. This is a black town of 1,500 people. So here you have a situation where black people are running their own town, living in their own town, and now you've got outsiders coming in the neighboring areas of Tennessee, the state, that are trying to take it over, trying to give them an ultimatum. They want them to give up their charter, and we can't let that happen. They don't want that to happen. And this is the person who put that in there. Thank you. That is true. Integration drained us of our best and brightest. Yeah, integration did hurt us in a lot of ways. But I want you all to realize, too, that this town right here is a town made up of majority black people. So even when we have our own towns, we have to be aware that there's always people from the outside who want to creep in and either destroy what we have, take what we have. And this is the question. We've got to be like Mr. Tibbs. Okay. In the heart of it, we got to be like Mr. Tibbs.
They call me Mr. Tibbs.
We got to fight it. We got to fight. We got to fight. We got to fight. And the people in this town, from what I can gather, they are trying to fight. Okay. They're trying to fight. We live in a crazy world. We're in a crazy world, ladies and gentlemen. You see that globe right behind me, that planet right behind me. We're in a crazy world, ladies and gentlemen, where we got people trying to take stuff from us. We got to fight for whatever's ours, just like any other group would fight for what's theirs. But this is the BS that's going on in this society that we're in that's causing these problems. These black people right here are saying we've had enough. They are concerned. They have paid their taxes. They live in their own thriving town, but are being treated like garbage. And you just can't allow that to happen. So I just want you all to spread this video around. I want y'all to be aware of this. This has everything to do with a money grab. They're trying to take from these black people. This is the mayor's office. This is the sister who is the vice mayor. She's the vice mayor right here. I'm gonna give you a close up of her right now. Here we go. There she is right there. She's a sister that was talking about the fact that we can't give up our charter. We can't do this. We just can't. And you've got the usual suspects again, trying to tell black people what to do with our town, with our business, trying to tell us what to do. And it ain't going to be that way. We've got these good old boys trying to tell us what to do. And we're not going to let that happen.
How does that get justified? And what is the situation with the finances specifically?
20 years of poor financial management in Mason. What we're trying to do is help them get on track so that they can benefit from all the development that's coming to their area.
And why?
Bullshit. The usual suspects. 20 years. How did he say that, folks? 20 years of financial mismanagement and development. What we're trying to do is get them on board so that they can benefit from the prosperity. No, you're trying to take them over because you want to benefit from their prosperity. Their future prosperity. You're trying to take it. And you want to dilute the vote by taking over their town so that you can dilute the voting block that they have as well. We know what's going on. And then the state of Tennessee, the good old boys, they're a part of it too. This is crazy, ladies and gentlemen. I'm getting ready for the next topic of the day. This was the main topic. Make sure you share and like this video. This was the main topic of the day, ladies and gentlemen. Here comes the next topic coming now. Lion's Den, anybody who wants to come on the panel in a little bit, hold your horses because I just want to get through a couple of quick stories here. Remember I did this story several months ago, maybe even last year. This was about the young man, a Jamaican immigrant who went on a hunting trip. That's his wife or his girlfriend or his wife, his significant other, who is pregnant with his child. I don't know if she's had the baby yet or not, but this brother went on a hunting trip with white men from his job. He ends up no longer with us. They killed him. And the family were concerned. The mother was concerned about, wait a minute, where's the justice? Where is the justice? All right. Black man hunted hunting trip death is ruled a self-defense. So now, ladies and gentlemen, there is no justice for this young man at all. Pennsylvania authorities announced that this week that no charges will be filed in the death of a black man who was fatally shot 9 times during a hunting trip. In a statement to the Daily Beast, attorney for Peter Spencer is his name. Peter Spencer's family said that they disagree with the county district attorney decision, but are not surprised by the outcome. This is the type of behavior we have seen from the Pennsylvania State Police County District Attorney from the outset. Attorney Paul Jubbase wrote, he added that the family will hold a press conference about the decision next week. Spencer, a black Jamaican immigrant, was shot and killed December 12th after his pregnant fiance, right here, pregnant fiance dropped him off in a remote area. The brother should have never did this. I talked about this before. We as black people born in America, we understand the history of America. We understand it very well. When it comes to our Caribbean and African brothers and sisters, y'all got to listen to what we tell you.
Tell the truth.
Because we know the lay of this land and we know the things that go on in America better than any goddamn body. You should listen to us. We built this damn place. We know every nick and cranny of its issues, especially when it comes to dealing with the usual suspect.
Tell the truth.
I want y'all to listen to the truth. Spencer, a black Jamaican immigrant, was shot and killed December 12th after his pregnant fiance dropped him off in a remote area, Rockland County, for a hunting trip with friends and former coworkers who were white. And four other men. Several hours into the trip, Spencer was shot by the co-workers 9 times. The men claimed that it was self-defense. District Attorney Sean Wright said that Spencer was acting crazy, firing off the AK-47 after taking mushrooms. So they're saying because he was on drugs. But where did he get the drugs at? Did the usual suspect introduce the drugs to him? Since that's what they're trying to claim here, mushrooms on the trip. He was shot after pointing the gun at the friends and ordering another man to get down on the ground at gunpoint. Witnesses said, according to the right, at one point, he allegedly claimed he was going to shoot up the place. It was the last 10 minutes where it escalated to the point of no reason, loss of reality, absolutely no listening to trying to de-escalate the situation. White said, adding that authorities found the hallucinogens in his system. The district attorney ultimately determined that the shooting was justified under the state stand-your-own-ground law. Isn't that a trip? Isn't it a trip how when it comes to stand your own ground, it never works for black people? You see what happened to Trayvon Martin, where that monster was able to get away with stand your own ground. Why is it that stand your own ground doesn't work for black people in America, but it works for everybody else? It usually works for the usual suspects and everything like that. You see that right there. But it doesn't work for us. District attorney ultimately determined that the shooting was justified under the state stand your own ground castle doctrine. They always throw that out when they do this to us, ladies and gentlemen. The district attorney ultimately determined that the shooting was justified under that law. Previous interviews with the Daily Beast, Spencer's mother, and let me put her up here, right now. This is a damn shame.
Tell the truth.
Daily Beast, Spencer's mother, Hunter, question the group narrative of how the shooting unfolded. They said Peter was going crazy shooting at people in crowd, and she said, adding that police had told her no one else got shot that night. Nobody got hurt, but he got shot and got killed. So basically, they're claiming that he shot at people, but there was no evidence that he shot at anybody that night, and none of these guys got shot themselves, but they took her son out of here. And now his fiance does not have. So this is what America is made of, ladies and gentlemen. We never get any justice. It's just us, ladies and gentlemen. There's no justice for black people in America at the end of the day, but there's just us.
Tell the truth.
Now, so this is a shame. This is a follow-up. He's not going to get justice. Nothing is going to happen. The brother is not going to get justice, ladies and gentlemen. This is a complete shame. I feel bad for the mother, the family. They want justice, but they've been able to allow the usual suspects to get off because of this castle doctrine, stand your own ground, which only seems to work for certain people in this society who don't look like us. When it's black people, I wonder if, check this out. Imagine, ladies and gentlemen, if it was a group of all black men and one white boy who went on a hunting trip and the white boy ended up shot. Would they be able to say, oh, stand your own ground? How many of you believe, if you do not believe, that the table would be turned fairly the other way around? Put a one in the chat room if you believe that, yes, if it was a black, all black men and one white dude and he got shot like this, that the white dude would have got justice in this situation. Put a one in the chat room if you agree with my point that I just made there. If you're not sure, it's okay. So we're going to go over to the next story, the next situation that I want to bring up. And here we go right now. The next story coming up for you right now.
You are listening to Information Man. Please make sure to subscribe to his channel.
Tell the truth.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, this is another. This is a report on Messy Jesse. Looks like Messy Jesse is not going to do 150 days, ladies and gentlemen. Looks like he got out, and Messy Jesse. What he's trying to say right now is that the reason why, remember, Messy Jesse is trying to blacken it up. He's trying to be black power. You know, he walked out of the court, as you remember, I did a story on him last week. He walked out of the court with his hands with the black power fist. And then he walks out of court. I mean, he walks out of jail because they were able to, go to court and appeal the situation, which they had every right to do. But Messy Jesse walks out with his brothers and his armed security. They're all wearing black as if this is about some black power move here. But then at the same time, Messy Jesse's brother wants to come out and say, well, you know, the reason why they, check this out, ladies and gentlemen, they want to put on this black power persona and talk about, well, he got railroaded because he's black. Yes, the court system, the Cook County is terrible. It's racist. Black men do get disproportionately charged for things that they should not get charged. And yes, you can make the argument that Messy Jesse should have never been given 150 days. And that's why they were able to circumvent the system and get him out through the legal law. But what bothers me is that Jesse and his family are trying to put on this black power persona as they were leaving court. I'm going to show you the video. While at the same time, his brother is trying to blame homophobic stuff on black people, saying that the reason why they were able to do this to him because they played on the homophobic. And homophobia means that you have fear of something. Black people don't have any fear of people that are of the alternative lifestyle. We may not agree with it. And just because you don't agree with that lifestyle does not mean that you fear people that are of that lifestyle. You may not agree with the lifestyle and want the lifestyle for yourself. But they like to throw around that word, homophobic, and they're using that term. Jesse's messy brother is using that term on black folks. This is what he's saying. Let me pull the audio up for you. So you come out of prison or out of jail with the black power look, and then you got your brother sitting up here dumping on Black America, saying, well, it's because they played on Black America's fears about gay people. But I didn't hear them say anything about the LGBTQ. They didn't do anything for Messy Jesse. They didn't come out there and support Messy Jesse. I haven't seen, he didn't say anything about the white racist LGBTQ in within that movement. Did they come out and support Jesse? Of course, we had a lot of people supporting them in the beginning, but has the LGBTQ as a community or the white LGBTQ, have they come out and talked about the railroading of his sentence? Have they said anything? Black folks already knew that he lied. It was proven. Jesse lied to the police. He lied in a report. And Black people in Chicago knew he lied. We all knew he lied. But because we weren't rocking with his lie, now his brother wants to turn around and say, oh, they played on our homophobic beliefs and feelings. Didn't say a damn thing about the LGBTQ who have left him for debt. But now all of a sudden, we got Messy Jesse playing the Black Power move on us. And then there's footage of old Messy Jesse calling himself the Black Gay Tupac. That's laughable. I want y'all to hear this from his brother right now. I think this is a younger brother. Listen to this audio.
Our community is innately has a lot of homophobia in it. And they leveraged that fact. They knew that ultimately Jesse was not going to get the same type of support as a straight Black man. Mm. And it's been obvious. I find it very difficult to believe that this ever would have gotten this far if Jesse was a straight Black man. And so we need to really think about that. Celebrities, common people, everyone. We need to think about the fact that literally society at large failed him. Mm-hmm. And hopefully one day the truth comes out to where people can see it clear as day. I don't know how they don't see it now, but hopefully someday that happens. And when that day happens, it's really a shame that it took that long for folks to understand that.
Jockey, so you think that if Jesse were a straight Black man, the public reception would have been way less intent on vilifying him from the jump?
Hands down. As a straight Black man, that is hands down what would have happened. Our community is innately has a lot of homophobia in it. And
let me stop right there. This is BS. The reason why Black people were not rocking with Messy Jesse is because we did not believe his story. He lied. He made the story up. He embellished the story. He was found to be lying in court. He lied to the police. We didn't believe it. Black people in Chicago know that the mega hats, people, Trump supporters are not big in Chicago. Everybody knows that in Chicago, that you don't have people running around with mega hats. His story was ill-perceived. He talks about he was going for that sandwich when he, wait a minute, if you were going for a sandwich, you could have called Uber Eats or anything like that. That's why Black people weren't rocking with Jesse. And nothing to do with his sexuality. Hell, look, Black people were watching the Empire show. We were watching that show. It had nothing to do with his homosexuality, even if we didn't agree with his homosexual or not. That's not why Black people weren't rocking with him. We weren't rocking with Messy Jesse because we could see through the lies and the BS. So now his brother jumps out the window and wants to throw the blame on Black people because the media played on him, his No, the media didn't play on his sexuality. The media said nothing about his sexuality. They were focusing on the fact that he lied. And the two dudes that he put up to this, they came to court and testified against Jesse and said, yeah, he gave us the money. We have video. And not to go over this whole story again, one of those brothers are suing his lawyers for defamation, saying that they were involved in pushing steroids. So they're getting ready to be sued. His lawyers, Jesse's lawyers, are getting ready to be sued by the two guys that Jesse put up to this whole mess. That's the reason why the Black community cut their support off from Jesse. Had nothing to do with the fact of his sexuality. That's pure BS. But it's funny how his brother dumps on the Black community, but he has said nothing about the LGBTQ, the gay community, that has done nothing thus far to support his brother. They have not come out and said anything at all. Hell, we got Black folks out here that are saying that he shouldn't have got 150 days in the first place. Messy Jesse. This is something else, folks. Let me play the little video as I move on to the other topic before I bring people on the platform. Here we go.
Cook County Jail as a free man for now. An appeals court made the decision to release him while he waits on an appeal for results of his conviction.
Jesse, how does it feel to be free?
Walking out of jail, saying nothing to reporters, Jesse Smollett hurried to his SUV after an appeals court 2-1 vote allowed him to go free. It was supposed to be a 150-day sentence. Instead, Jesse Smollett served just 6 days. He was allowed to walk away after posting a personal reconnaissance bond of $150,000, which means he doesn't have to put down money but agrees to come to court as required. You may remember 3 years ago when Jesse Smollett, a black gay man, claimed he was a victim of a racist and homophobic attack by two men wearing ski masks. He was charged and convicted after an investigation discovered he orchestrated the attack and lied to police about it. Smollett maintained his innocence throughout the trial, even during his sentencing.
If I did this, then it means that I stuck my fist in the fears of black Americans in this country for over 400 years and the fears of the LGBTQ community. Your Honor, I respect you and I respect the jury, but I did not do this.
Jesse's lawyers filed an emergency injunction last Friday requesting his release, saying he's in danger behind bars. His lawyers have criticized the special prosecutor's decision to charge him after Jesse paid a $10,000 fine and the initial charges were dropped by Cook County State's Attorney Kim Fox. They're claiming there's legal double jeopardy and a double standard on how black men are treated in the judicial system.
Mr. Smollett paid a $10,000 fine. Let me repeat it again, because our appellate courts are listening. Paid a $10,000 fine and did community service. Now, there's no time machine to go back in time to undo those things. His $10,000 fine hasn't even been returned to him.
We had letters of support from the NAACP who talked about the disparate treatment that black males receive in the criminal justice system. It is time to have that conversation, and we are elated that the appellate court is able to decipher the legal issues here and apply the correct standard.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, thank you. Let's go to the next. That's what's going on with Jesse. So he's out, but I don't like the fact that his brother is trying to push this narrative on black people, because we didn't rock with Jesse because we saw him as a liar. It had nothing to do with his sexuality. Now, are there people out there who had an attitude because of his sexuality? Yeah, I'm not going to deny that. There's probably people out there who have an attitude. But that's not why black people pulled away from him. We saw it for what it is, a lie. And I'm going to tell you this right now. His family, they are reinforcing and they're in denial of what this what he did, what was wrong. Jesse put himself in this mess and he's got no one else to blame but himself for being in this situation as it is, ladies and gentlemen. Let me go on to the next story. Before we get ready to have a panel, I got to bring in the next story right here. And I'm going to just bring it on in right here. This one right here, I got to be honest about. And right here, you all know the story. Okay, we've got Don Lemon, as I like to call him, Lemonhead. Myself personally, Don Lemonhead. Don Lemonhead, right now. So Don Lemon was every night on primetime on CNN. He's always cushioning up to Chris Cuomo. Kissy, 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 kissy. Oh, I love you, my brother. You're my brother. You're my brother. You're my brother, Chris Cuomo. You're my brother. And so what happened is that... Chris Cuomo is suing CNN and he's throwing Don Lemon under the damn bus. And it's come to find out Don Lemon has had a few things to say about Chris Cuomo. So Chris Cuomo is trying to sue them for money loss. And guess what? Chris Cuomo was making $6 million while Don Lemon was making $4 million. Don Lemon's busting his butt. He's making $4 million. Chris Cuomo was making $6 million, more than Don Lemon. And when they got rid of Chris Cuomo, they didn't even make Don Lemon the primetime man. That's a damn shame. Remember they were best friends? Here they are chumming up to each other. Here's a picture of them chumming up to each other. That's Don Lemon, hand in hand, going on family trips together, hanging out together, shaking hands. Don Lemon every night talking about how much he loves Chris Cuomo, calling Chris Cuomo his brother. Chris Cuomo acting like he's this liberal Italian white guy from New York, understanding what black folks go through on CNN when he does his little editorial shows and things of that nature. Well, he threw Don Lemon's black ass under the bus. Tell the truth about that.
Tell the truth.
And Don Lemon was doing all that crying and soaking. This is what, look at right here. Don Lemon started crying on air as soon as he saw Chris Cuomo get kicked out of the CNN. And he's crying for him. But now Chris Cuomo is doing what the usual suspects do. He's throwing Don Lemon under the bus. He's throwing him right under the collective bus. And Don Lemon is now the victim of this man's lawsuit against CNN. Throwing him in. Did you think about the message it's sending? And this is Don Lemon. Did you think about the message that it was sending to journalists in the company and to the large public that someone can find a break with those journalist standards and then get paid handsomely for it? Lemon grilled Warner Media CEO Jason Kilar during the New York Chat Insider Report. This is Don Lemon. And what is stopped the next person? What stops the next person from possibly getting compensated for it to spread rumors or what have you to press? This is Don Lemon. Now, Chris Cuomo now. Also, Chris Cuomo also took aim at several other former CNN colleagues alleging a breach of company ethics without punishment. Look, CNN, MSNBC, the Fox propaganda news, it's all corrupt. It's all BS. It's all BS. Okay, he files and cites that the lead host, Jake Tapper, privately suggested that Republican congressional candidate Sean Pernin run in a safer district instead of against incumbent Republican. Look, this is all the BS. These people are doing stuff behind the scenes. These are the people that's giving you mainstream news behind the scenes, and they're involved in all type of corrupt and nasty and sticky stuff. So Don Lemon, the lemon head is on you because you were on there caping and cooning it up for this man who is now throwing you under the bus. You sitting up there crying it up for this man while this man has thrown you under the bus. And that's what you get, Don Lemon, because you should have known better. You should have known better. And that's what that one is there, ladies and gentlemen. Here comes another story coming up, like right now as well, ladies and gentlemen, right now.
Tell the truth.
Okay, ladies and gentlemen, I want y'all to see this. This is called Meta Slaves. This is what's happening. You know how you've got this, what is this, NFT, where you can own electronic art and people are trading this stuff like they're doing cryptocurrency? Well, this was on Twitter where you have people that are actually buying black slave or black people as images on NFT. And this is called Meta Slaves. This was on Twitter. This was on Twitter, ladies and gentlemen. So there's people out there that are really purchasing black people as slaves on this whole NFT. Check this out. Let me put this up here. Right up here. So here you have, this is a Facebook page. Meta Slave. So you can actually buy an image of a black person as your slave. This is was a site. I want to help black people. This project will help them if you deem those who want to do good. You are a terrible person. With this project, we want to show everyone that we will never forget the victims of our ancestors. We must remember history so that it doesn't not happen again. This is Meta Slaves on Twitter. Images at art galleries that people can buy as a collection for their NFT, Meta Slaves NFT. This is what's going on, ladies and gentlemen. I want y'all to see this. What does everybody in the chat room think about what I just am showing you? What are your thoughts? What are your thoughts, ladies and gentlemen? We got Tiffany Jackson. Chief is in the house. We got to go. Yeah. LP got to go. Right. Deborah Catch by Faith. Thank you for being here, sister. Make sure you subscribe to the Info Media channel. The Info Media channel. Supreme Court Justice Clarence Thomas hospitalized with an infection. Breaking news. Okay. Clarence Thomas, a black man who's done nothing for black people the whole time he's been on the Supreme Court. He says nothing. He's done nothing for us. And his wife was involved in that January 6th situation. So, hey, it is what it is about Clarence Thomas right now. Marcella Muhammad says, I'm cooking dinner for the family. Did anyone answer my question about why do the alphabet community say they are gay? Tupac. Was Tupac gay? I'm not just. No, I think that Jesse Smollett was saying that is to say that basically saying that Tupac was a tough brother. Right. He's a brother that stood up for the community. So I think he's saying that as a gay black man, he's being a gay black man standing up for what's right. It's a play on words is what Jesse was trying to do. But Jesse, I'm sorry, Jesse lied. And while he wants to call himself the gay black Tupac, that came out of his own words. You can see the footage online where he said that. Online when he said that, ladies and gentlemen. It doesn't hold water when his brother is now trying to throw us under the bus because we weren't supporting him because we realized that he was a liar. But to get on, what's going on, Beverly Palmas? To put it in perspective here, I want y'all to really look at this Meta Slave. This is what's happening on the internet where people are auctioning off images of black people as if we are slaves in this whole NFT digital world. This NFT digital world, this is the kind of stuff that's coming to this digital world. Okay, let me go into this issue right here. We got Brittany Griner. Nobody gives a damn about Brittany Griner. I know she's a member of the LGBTQT and everybody says, oh, black people, y'all don't. I don't care about her sexuality. What I do care about is the fact that she's a top athlete, one of the best black basketball players in this country. I do know that she is over in Russia. She's being held on some bogus reasons. There's a war going on over there. I don't see what the Biden administration or anybody is doing to get her out of that situation. It's a bad situation. She plays basketball over there. If you're wondering, well, why was she over there? She plays basketball over there because women's NBA does not make the kind of money that men do. So they go over to Europe to make extra money during the offseason in the WNBA. So that's why she was over there. Apparently, I think she's married or she has a partner. She's over there. She's in prison. The last time they talked about her and showed her, she did not look good. And let's not let her be a forgotten person in this whole conflict that's going on over there right now. This is a damn shame. No one has done anything within this government to get her out of this situation. No one is saying anything. And I just want to bring it up to people as a reminder of the bull crap that's going on out here. So let's get at it, folks. I really appreciate you all. As I said, again, my main topic, I just wanted to touch on those topics very quickly. Another topic right now I want to touch on briefly because I have a video for you. All of you have heard about the auction at the school. White students held a mock slavery auction with black classmates sold off as slaves. With the N-word, a school in North Carolina was condemned after some white students held a mock slave auction in which they pretended to sell off black colleagues and say the slang the N-word. The incident early this month at JSW Water School near Raleigh came to light after a black student who was the target of this situation, Jeremy, told his mother, Ashley Palmer, she posted about this on Facebook. I think all of you, I think the young man's biracial or something like that. But let me show you the video before we get the panel up here real quick. And let's see that video right now. Here we go.
14-year-old eighth grader here at J.S. Waters School. She says he's on the baseball team. And what happened all played out on the baseball field.
This is the letter Chatham County School Superintendent Dr. Anthony Jackson sent to all parents Tuesday night, vaguely addressing what he referred to as recent incidents involving students using racially insensitive language and offensive imagery, something he said will not be tolerated.
Yeah, it didn't give any details as to really what it was, you know, just that they were kind of taking care of it or whatever.
Some parents in the J.S. Waters School carpool line now finding out it was last week. Ashley Palmer says her son and his teammates were on the field at baseball practice when some of the white students carried out a mock slave auction. Palmer writing on Facebook, his friend went for $350 and another student was the slave master because he knew how to handle them. Palmer tells ABC 11, as far as she knows, the baseball coach was unaware of what happened, but when she told administrators, the students involved were suspended for one day. And upon their return, one hit her son with a baseball several times, claiming it was an accident. Dr. Jackson, in his letter, said, I want to be clear. Racist, homophobic, or otherwise hateful behavior or speech has no place in the Chatham County school system.
We talk to our kids about that sort of thing. So, you know, what's right or wrong and, you know, how to treat people.
A school district spokesperson would not confirm how many students were involved or what actions they'd taken. Palmer says administrators have now contacted her, expressing concern for families on the other side of the incident who say they're being targeted. Palmer telling ABC 11, I'm empathetic with these individuals because there's children involved. However, I wish the concern for protection translated to the protection of our son as well.
Palmer says she and her family are seeking legal action for what she referred to as assault and continuous harassment toward her son.
A sea of support calling for change.
This will not tolerate atrocious acts.
After Ashley Palmer says her black son's classmates held a slave auction at J.S. Waters School in Goldston.
This is not diversity and inclusion. This is not equity. This is racism and deserves to be treated as such.
About 100 people showed support for the eighth grader's family at a rally organized by Chatham Organizing for Racial Equity and inside the school board meeting.
Which side of history will you be on?
The community called on the board to put tangible changes in place.
Let this student and other students who suffered similar indignities be agents of change.
The mother of another student says her child was bullied during the slave auction.
I am a mother who just had to explain to my son why being auctioned as a slave is unacceptable. This moment in my son's early life has already made him question playing the sport he loves with his friends.
Superintendent Dr. Anthony Jackson laid out a plan he says will begin the healing process and ensure this never happens.
An apology to every single student who has ever felt unsafe while in our care. To every student who has ever felt demeaned, disrespected, or marginalized.
The board unanimously approved a plan that includes revisions to the student code of conduct, staff training, and building relationships with local community agencies, including those who spoke Monday.
Okay, everybody. Thank you. Thank you for listening to that. It's what I'm going to do. I got my man from BS3 Network, Brother Ben, saying, good evening, information man. BS3 Network is a network that I'm a part of. The brother, I know him from podcasting. He has a network where he has sports. He has community talk on the network. He has political, cultural talk like this, religious talk as well. Everything on the platform. You can catch us on Roku TV. If you look for the BS3 Network on Roku TV on that package, you'll be able to see me live on Roku TV right on your TV, of course, and as well as on Facebook. He's all over Facebook as well. I want to thank him for coming over. Give him a clap. Brother Ben, we got Trap. We got Trap Vision 3D in the house, and I want to thank you. So once again, I did talk about some other issues here, but the main theme issue of the day is about Mason, Tennessee, a thriving black town. A black town of 1,500 black people. They have the Blue Oval City coming there, which is owned by Ford. They're making an electric truck plant. The town of Mason, Tennessee is going to boom economically. They're being taken over They're trying to take them over, the state of Tennessee, as well as the neighboring town, Tipton County, is trying to take them over by saying that, oh, they've been fiscally irresponsible for over 20 years. So we want to get them in line by engulfing them, taking them over and taking over their charter where they don't have control of their own damn charter. This is just about economics. It's about money. They don't want to see this black town get an economic boom like they've never seen before because of this factory, because they want to engulf them with Tipton County, which is mainly a white town, mainly Republican, to take them over, to dilute their voting power as well, and take over the economics and money and destiny and take it away from a town that could actually boom, and the state stepping in and playing with them. Prior to that, they didn't give a damn about this town. They didn't give a damn about the people. As you can see them in their town hall talking about it, they're not very happy at all about what's going on. I just want to show you these pictures real quick as a summary. This is the vice mayor that was speaking in some of the videos that I showed you and what have you. So what I'm going to do, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to hit a little music on while I get ready to put a link in the chat room. For those of you who want to come on the panel, we're going to talk for a brief moment about the Mason, Tennessee issue that I brought up earlier in the show. So let's get started. Tell her I can't snake me. Ray gun off safety. My girl so tasty. Tell her it's your world. She want the two-tone spaceship. Blow smoke screen daily. So the stress don't faze me. I'm going. I keep it factual. I'm on sabbatical. I'm out of Central America. I need a break from hysteria. Park like the one with the carousel. I get it lit in your area. I'm locked to the vision. It couldn't be clear. You couldn't pay me to care enough. I dare you to hate me supreme with the sound through the stereo. So turn it up loud when you hearing us. We live and it's good in your area. My mama proud. She tearing up and it's going down. Got your girl aroused by these massive stacks like 100 pounds. Running big laps till the sun is down like 100 miles. Tinted frames on me leaning down. Winning now. Been a while. You ain't like me then, but how you like me now? Red one, if I hold you down, I'ma keep it there till we in the ground. Jet black when I paint the town, only blue sheets when they pay me now. Treat a setback like a step back. Wave, I got the game in a vice grip. Way up when the virus clear. All the homies on the flight list. Verbally gifted, take the plot and I twist it. Got a big lit. Sage with the incense, got my mind red, so won't stop, I'm relentless. I'ma need safety. Tell her I can't snake me. Ray gun off safety. My girl so tasty. Tell her it's your world. She want the two-tone spaceship. Smoke screen daily, so the stress don't faze me. I'm going. I want a girl for the mouthpiece, so bright that it light on my face. Your shawty just call me a fave, cause she like my character traits. I never stop for a break. I put a lock on the game, I put a stock in my name, but I give a fuck about the fame. I took a bite out of life and it tastes so exquisite. It feel like you do when you look in my pendant. Hopeless romantic, my girl, chin up for the kid. I'm not on no cinch. Won't stop till the youngest he dreams. Wanna take her from rags to riches. I heard that you claim that you know me, but you ain't the homie. The fuck is your friendship? I need a loyalty, bag up the royalty. I give a fuck if you notice me. Ain't nobody holding me. Big wave at your shoreline, so they know it's me. Bay boy from the cold seas. Nitro with a new pen. Go at ISO, tell him don't reach. Ice cold with it, no fleece.
Tell the truth.
I'ma need safety. Tell her I can't snake me. Ray gun off safety. My girl so tasty. Tell her it's your world. She want the two-tone spaceship. Blow smoke screen daily, so the stress don't faze me. I'm going, hey, look, I'm going, yeah, I'm going, crazy, wave, yeah, crazy, yeah, look, I'm going, crazy, wave, hey, look, I'm going, yeah, I'm going, crazy, wave, yeah.
I can't hear you.
There we go. Super Mike. Thank you, everybody. Super Mike's on with us, and I'm glad that he's here. Thank you for your patience. Super Mike, did you have a chance, and welcome. Thank you for being here, brother. Did you have a chance to hear the beginning of my statements on this show when it started about Mason, Tennessee? I want to make that the main conversation here, brother.
Yes, sir. Yeah, I heard it. I heard it. I actually did a little thing on this, on my thing too. So I researched it. You know, we actually had a Twitter space interview with the mayor and the vice mayor and the city attorney over there, and they gave some inside details about some of the history. Yeah, and I mean, this is just old school stuff. It's just like you said. I mean, you pretty much laid that thing out pretty good, bro. And Yeah, you showed the news clippings. I mean, the news, they, you, if you notice the news clippings that you've shown and the ones that I've found, mm-hmm. I mean, the news is in line trying to justify, you know, like, well, you know, the financial mismanagement, you know. But if we went to Nashville, say, or we went to some of these other Murfreesboro, if we find a financial mismanagement there, he didn't take them over. You know, he didn't take them over. What's the name? Mumpherson?
Yeah, Mumpower, what have you, Mumpower. I think is his name. Yeah, I can't say the damn name. Mumpower. What's going on, Rico Bizarre Foods? What's going on? Everybody check out Rico Bizarre Foods. Check out each other's channels, Trap Vision. Everybody in the chat room, check out each other's channels and make sure that you write each other's name down. Check out Super Mike, who I have up here. Make sure you check out the Info Media channel, content creation channel. But let's get back on track, brother. So, yeah, so you did a story about this. And
yeah, I'll check into it.
There's been a lot of towns that have had some financial problems, mm-hmm. but you could tell in the, I don't know if you heard the audio that I played where you had a guy interviewing this guy, Mumpherson Power. And he said, well, why is it that all this time has passed? You say they've been in this bad shape since 20 years now. Mm-hmm. Even by the way, that financial issue that they have, it was actually created by white folks that were there before it became a black town. Then nobody wants to deal with that part too. But okay, they have some financial problems. But all this time you weren't worrying about them until Ford comes to town because you can smell the money.
Yep. See, it's right there. You got it. Because this is the thing, man. And you pushing it out there, and the more of us understand, like, we do have power in our voice,
right?
And we have power in our actions. The mm-hmm. more of us understand that, you know, they're going to attack us when we get something, and we have to be able to defend ourselves, you know. So we have to, it's like you're doing, focus ourselves over there. You know, can we get this guy recalled?
Right.
Does the city need some money, some better attorneys? I think that, yeah, they were over there talking about that. The mayor was talking about the county mayor mm-hmm. wants to take over that city because they wanted to. They have been wanting to take over that city because they wanted to run the sewers through the black town, basically.
Right.
They want to run.
Okay, cool. Lion's Den's coming on board with us. Right. Exactly.
Right. Yep, right. That's kind of how the situation with Flint happened.
Now check this out. Lion's Den, Lib, this is my brother Lion's Den. We've been rocking for a long time.
What's up?
What's good, y'all?
Lion's Den, now, I don't know if you still live in Tennessee, but you were living in Tennessee, or if you're still there. Are you still there?
No, unfortunately, I'm still living in New Mexico, but I still got connects in Tennessee, however.
Okay. Now, tell me something if I'm right or wrong. In the presentation that I gave here, it talked about this Interstate 40, Highway 79, which is it's right dab in the middle or right next to this town, which means what? What does it mean? Let's use common sense here. It means that if you have a company there that's making a campus, that will bring an economic boom because people will stop in this town along the way. And if you have people who have businesses there and stores or what have you, they can get an economic boom from this particular plant, which was going to bring them jobs, which can also turn into them building stores and being, you know, creating some entrepreneurial opportunities because of this major highway. Are you familiar with that highway that I speak of, brother?
Unfortunately, no, but I noticed that the town of the Tennessee, which you guys were referring to,
yes.
30 miles outside of Memphis.
Mm-hmm.
And what is happening is that Mumpower. Yeah,
the usual suspect.
Right, exactly. Right. So Mumpower, you know, he's a comptroller of the state of Tennessee.
Comptroller, yeah, that's right.
Exactly. So his plan was that he was going to take over this town of Mason only because Ford Motor Company is planning to build a plant there to create jobs there. So right. Mumpower has decided that, oh, no, we're not going to allow that to happen. We're going to take full control and then blame the town with the vice mayor and the mayor of that town saying that he didn't pay no bills, they didn't pay no bills, blah, 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 blah. But at the end of the day, it's not the mayor, not the vice mayor. It's the state of Tennessee itself was the one. And before they even sworn in as mayor and vice mayor, they was the one that messed. They was the one that messed things up, not right. the mayor that's in right now. So at the end of the day, that we're planning to have a rally in Nashville, so we're planning a protest against Mumpower to really try to take him down, try to take him away from his power because he's power hungry. And I'm going to talk about that on my clubhouse tomorrow morning about the situation.
Okay. Hey, Lions Den, give me a call, brother. We need to do some things together, brother. It's been a minute since we've done anything together. I'm not on HAPS as much as I used to be.
Okay.
I still have HAPS. I can still use HAPS, but they kind of have favored people that are musicians. If you notice that. They're on a musician thing over there. They want to focus only on musical people on that platform. But I'm not on it as much as I used to. But connect with me because we need to do some things. We need to do some projects together, man. I need to get you on the platform so that you can give some weekly reports to the people, man. So keep me in mind and just send me a message. You know how to get in contact with me. But other than that, brother, you lived in Tennessee. Is this? I'm probably asking an obvious question. Is this just pure racism that they see these black people as an impediment? And I also feel this too. And I'm not saying that Democrats are the best thing or Republicans, but I see that if they are a Democratic town, this is another way for the Republicans to dilute the vote. Because if they make them a part of Timberland County, which is a white Republican county, if I'm not mistaken, Lions Den, if you're familiar with that county.
Yeah.
They will be able to overtake whatever the voting power that these black folks have from their town if they merge them with another county. You know, you see what I'm saying here? It's like redistricting. It's like they're doing a rezoning here. That's another trick game. You see?
If you notice too, Information Man, like I said, this is the exact same strategy that they use up in Michigan. They blame your town for having a financial problem. So they justify taking over the elected official's position in your town. And then they run something like a sewage through your town. And then it poisoned everybody. Okay. And just like this dude was saying on the clip that you played, I'm from Nashville, but I bought some land because I want to run a trailer park there. Why? Because to build those facilities, like people like me, I'm a construction guy. I'm an electrician. So I will travel out there. We have people that travel to those places. And in those little towns like that, there's 1,500 right now. Those little towns, they grow to like, 20,000, they grow to 30,000 people. Now those mayors, those black officials, they have a tax base now. They can start doing things that they always been wanting to do. They can issue permits, they can collect taxes. And guess what? Those people, that town will never go to 1,500 no more.
Right.
It will never go to 1,500.
Right. Do you brothers agree with this? Angelica said that the reality is that most suburban towns are a drain on the taxes. Is that a fact?
Not sure.
That's a very good point. I wouldn't mind her coming up to explain that more. I'd like to see more. I'd like to get more into that. That's a very interesting point. Now, we got Brother Jay, the informant, saying also one of the guys on the board of Ford just brought 100 acres of land over there in Tennessee area where they are building the site. And you saw in one of the clips, I think the second clip that I showed you, you had a white guy talking about he's going to build an RV park. So you already have white people coming into this area because they smell the money, baby. They're now coming into the, now check this out. This is how this works. This is very obvious. If this black town who has a 153-year-old charter that they have the rights over, if they maintain themselves as a town and you have people who move into the town to build infrastructure because they want to benefit from the people that will be going to that plant. Who will benefit? It will be the town in their tax base.
Facts.
And they don't want, they don't want us having control over that.
Right.
That's the issue.
So if Timberland County and the state of Tennessee takes over the town and just absorb them into a white town, then it will be that white town that will benefit from that tax base. As long as you let them stay black and black owned, then the people that's going to come in, because they're going to come, baby. They're going to come. They're going to come in and set up shop. You're going to have people building hotels, stores, whatever they're saying that they don't have now. People are going to come in to build it because they want to take advantage of that that business. And the town will ultimately, as I said before, will benefit from a tax base. Their tax base will increase and get better. Which will benefit who? If the majority of black people live in Madison, Texas, or Mason, Texas, let's be correct. If the majority are black people and people come in and set up shop, it will be black people that will get the economic benefit.
Exactly. And
tell the truth.
Check this out. Check this out. The mayor was also talking about how, you know, the state and everything. I think the county mayor, the mayor of Mason, when we did the interview on Twitter, he was talking about how these guys, they didn't put in a budget for any police. They don't have no police, but their crime is low. They don't have hardly had no crime. So, so you know how they have the narrative that black people are so dangerous. Everything that we do is about crime and stuff like that. But there wasn't hardly no crime there. And then, you know, every now and then they would need the police. The county refused to send police over there.
Right. Let me just say this. What's up, Red Squad X? Thank you, brother. He be doing some deep stuff on his channel. Real deep conversations he has over there. And we got my man O'Shea in the house. Now, look. Brother O'Shea has a channel where he does these simulations, where he does farming simulations and building like communities. It's funny, we're talking about a town here. Check out his channel. He goes live on his channel and you see him doing stuff. It's very interesting. It's a simulation game that he plays, but it's very interesting where he's building his farm up and everything. I just find it fascinating. I love to watch his channel when he goes live. Let me see what Angelica was saying here. She says, Angelica says, which the average home only pays a fraction of the cost of said maintenance. Interesting. Red Squad, this brother right here, man, he be getting into some deep conversation. I'm going to have to get you on the show, brother, at some point in time. You be having deep conversation on your channel over there. And sister, Boo gave me a super chat. Thank you. Thank you, my sister, for the super chat. Thank you.
Thank you for the super chat.
And let me give you a clap. Let me see. She says, yes, Angelica is right. Look at the comps. Most live in the suburbs, which drains the urban larger black areas of their tax dollars. That's true. If people from the suburbs come into the city to work, let me see, and then they leave with their paychecks and they go back to the suburbs and spend their money in the box stores in the suburbs, that's a very good point. Their money is being spent where they live. That's a very good point. I mean, people do spend money where they work too. They go to stores in the area that they work, but I can understand what you're saying because they're not living in the city, so they don't pay property tax in that city. And property tax is the heaviest part of the tax base for paying for what? The services in the city. Am I correct, Lion's Den and brother Mike, Super Mike? Is it the housing taxes that we pay are a big part of paying for the schools in the community and all the other things that we need in a community, right?
Yep.
So she would be correct. Yes.
But check this out too, information man. Because of the large influx of new people, right? Mm-hmm. That sales tax. That's going to skyrocket too, because that town is so close to where the workers are going to be for years building that facility. Right. And
Now, I brought this up too. When you talk about generational wealth, so let's say, couldn't this create generational wealth for this town? Because obviously you have a town where you have black people. I'm sure you have black children, black teenagers. Couldn't that help create generational wealth for those in that community? Possibly, if the town booms because of this company coming there, which
no doubt about it.
Because if they if they get absorbed by the other county, that money is going to be spread out amongst a larger number of people.
Mm-hmm.
So it's also shit. Slick.
Yeah, but the thing is, though, and for these people, it must have happened too fast because they're not doing it slick like they usually do. Mm-hmm. They're just like saying they gave this man two options. Like, you need to give up your charter, or we're gonna just take you over. And did it all publicly. And so, yeah, the people, the community were fighting, which is good that we're doing. But it's like, yeah, he said that the comptroller told them, you got to pay $22,000 every month before you pay any of your own bills to us. We need $22,000 off the top for a town of 1,500. You know, that's a lot for them, you know. Before they can pay any of their bills, and then blame them. Oh, y'all finances ain't right.
Yeah, man. I modded you out, brother, because I know I'm a mod on your channel, brother. Red X in there, Red Squad X. You're absolutely right, brother. This man, this is a question. Because I think the people there, they are attacking them when they're down right now. So they're trying to get them and justify why they're going to take it. Do you think that we're going to be looking at another situation of a black town that could have had potential with this new situation occurring around them economically? Is this going to be a situation where this town will be snatched up and absorbed? And is this going to happen? Lion's Den, what are your thoughts? You lived in Tennessee. You kind of know the lay of the land out there from the time that you lived out there. What are your thoughts, brother?
Well, Info, here's the biggest concern I have with this is that Mumpower already threatened that he's going to go ahead and take over. They didn't give us no notice. They don't give the people notice or warning or anything. He's going to say, I'm just going to take over. And here's the problem with this. And I think this is why, and guess what? The media coverage, you know, they didn't think that there's going to be no media coverage on this story.
And so
all the social media is already covering the story, myself included, the town of Mason is going to have a hostile takeover because of a Mumpower. But again, this is a message that they're sending the state of Tennessee that we're just going to go ahead and take over because Ford Motor Company is planning on building a plant there. So the biggest, because they know that it's going to bring money to the town. Now, the concern is that if it happens in Mason, it's going to happen in Pine Bluff, Arkansas, because Pine Bluff, Arkansas already called themselves the Black Wall Street. So you will have all these black towns targeted because of the hate of racist politicians and racist like comptrollers of state legislators that think they can just take over a town because they're going to make some money by a Ford Motor Company, which is ridiculous.
Right. Now, let me say this. Thank you for the super chat again, my sister. I really appreciate that. Let me give you a clap. Thank you.
Thank you.
She says the salary is being paid by the Irvin Minority Dwellers Tax dollars. Thank you for that statement. But Angelica made a good point here. Let me read what Angelica said right here, because this is something that we had to keep in mind. And maybe I talked a little bit too soon, but she says, I doubt it. Big business that moves or sets up shop in a new town typically takes years from the proposal to groundbreaking. The county knew they did not tell the town their intention. Did you hear what she just wrote? Did y'all absorb what? That's some deep stuff here. So basically, this was long in the making, and Tipton or whatever the hell that county is, they knew that this was coming down the pipeline probably before the town knew it of Mason, Tennessee.
Yep.
They knew it and they set back and they said, you know what? Check this out. Woo, check this out. They set back and they said, just let the town fall apart. We know that they got some fistful problems that we contribute to. Just let it keep falling apart. That's why when the guy asked him, why you waited 20 years? Why you guys wait 20 years? Because they purposely let them fall into a situation economically that they were having a hard time because they knew that this was coming, that this Ford plant was coming. And they said, this is the time, like a snake slithering on the ground. This is the time to now attack them while they're down and they're weak and we can crush them. Boom. This was a planned assassination on this town.
But Info, I got a little hope for this town because the thing is, like you said, the previous white leaderships and stuff, they actually caused that problem, right? They actually stole $600,000 from this town. It was a white guy. And so the comptroller all of a sudden wants them to pay, y'all owe basically $600,000. Okay.
Wait a minute, Super Mike. I need you, let me put you front and center. I need you to say that again so everybody can hear that. Why are they in this situation? Go ahead, Super Mike. Say it again nice and loud.
Well, there's a white guy who actually stole. He was part of the leadership of Mason within the last 20 years. He literally got in trouble. So this is on my Twitter. So this is documented. I'm not saying nothing. I came back up. He stole $600,000 from this town of Mason,
Tennessee. Tell the truth.
And then here comes the comptroller now. Like you said, they already knew this was going on. And even the mayor said when he was talking, he was saying how, they would be having these meetings about the area, but they wouldn't let us come in for years.
Right.
Mm-hmm. Yep. See? And so, and like I said, all of that's recorded and documented. And like I said, I sent you a link on your Twitter. I'll send you these links on your Twitter.
Okay. So wait a minute, Super Mike. So basically, this isn't a case of a black town of 1,500 black people who just fumbled their economics by themselves. It was a white dude who caused this problem, left them holding the bag. It's just like if you're in a relationship with somebody and you break out, you get out of that relationship or that marriage, and then you're left with all this debt that you didn't actually, somebody that you went into business with, that's a better analogy. That's not marriage, because in marriage, both people commingle the economics. Let's say you're in business with somebody, your business partner was doing stuff that you didn't know, and you get left holding the bill that your business partner jumped out of. And now people are saying, you owe us this money. And it looks like you created the problem when it was actually created by somebody else that you were in business partnership with, or someone that was in. And so now they're sitting back and trying to make us think that this town did all of this by themselves, to themselves.
Mm-hmm.
So ain't that some treacherous stuff? One of your own people caused this problem. You let it fester for years and years with no assistance to this town. You didn't give a damn about them. A big old factory's coming to town, and now you say, you guys are having a hard time, and you've been fiscally irresponsible. We're going to teach you how to control your finances. And if you don't join with us over here,
we're trying to help you.
You're not going to be able to benefit from the future of the blue Ovo City Ford electric truck powered company. Something else? Ain't that you got a? Ain't that something, ladies and gentlemen?
Tell the truth.
Dang, this is how they set us up. And then, but the thing is, see, this is what I'm saying, Info. That's why I have hope, because this particular mayor and the vice mayor and the black leadership, they are fighting. You see, and that's what the black people want. Like, if the city. Like the comptroller came and threatened them, like, just give your city up to us. Not only did they say give it up, but I'm sure they probably haven't said it, but they said we'll have a little something in it for you if you just go ahead and comply. Well, and they were like, no, we're going to fight. So right. They're fighting.
Right, right.
Right. Mm-hmm. But check
this
out.
This is what I respect.
My man, Jay, the informant, he said he wouldn't be surprised if the guy that did all of this left out the door with a little money in the back pocket for himself. You know,
yeah.
You know, you never know what's going on. But yeah, I like the fact that these black folks are fighting. So everybody's, check this out, brother, because we hear this on YouTube, Super Mike, all the time. Oh, what are black men and black people doing to fight against the system? Wait a minute. This is a town made of black men and black women. They're fighting, ladies and gentlemen. So while we're sitting, and this is the thing I said earlier, we spend too much time on YouTube in particular, arguing and backbiting on each other when we have a real battle out here. Why don't people who do all this talking against each other, why don't you use your YouTube channels to talk about this issue, to bring more awareness to what's happening to black people in Mason, Tennessee? And believe me, Super Mike and Lion's Den and everybody in the chat room, this is not the only black town in America that is going to be under assault if there's not already one out there that is under assault that we just haven't heard about.
Right,
we just haven't heard about it yet because the mass media is not talking. Let's take a vote right now. If anybody in the chat room has heard about this story on mass media, that's CNN, that's MSNBC, the Fox Propaganda Channel, have any of you heard of any of this stuff outside of social media about this town or any town like it? Put a one in the chat room if you heard anybody on major news networks even talk about this town. Huh?
Here's what's so funny about it, Info. MSNBC just talk about the story.
They just talking about it now. Yeah, because of social, it's because we talking about it.
We're forcing them.
That's
why I have hope. That's the reason why I said Info. Our voices have power, and some of us don't see it.
Thank you, everybody in the chat room. Everybody's
look good taking over this town. Ford is not going to look good.
Ford not going to look good. But see, look, we know this. Ford is about money. So I wouldn't even see Ford wanting to get involved in this. I think Ford, at the end of the day, they're going to be the big winners because they're going to make money off of whatever happens. At the end of the day, they're going to make money. Because people within this area are going to swarm to get jobs there.
Well, yeah, they're going to make money. But what I'm saying is that stain forever on their record.
Uh-huh.
You see, because see, this is what I'm trying to tell people. Like, when you fight, even if you're a small town, it allows us all around the country, all around the world to get behind you.
Right.
Let's say they just gave up their charter. It's okay. You're going to take it over anyway. Y'all too powerful. There's no way we can win. And they just gave it up. We would have never known nothing about this.
Right. Let me say what's,
Go
ahead, brother.
Yeah, go ahead.
If
they fight. Oh, sorry.
Go ahead. If they fight. Go ahead, Super Mike.
No. I was just saying, if they fight, it just allows us to get behind them. And this is going to create a permanent record. Now, people are already messaging for CEO and to tell them to put the pressure on that comptroller, cease and desist.
Right. Angelica is saying that she hopes they're able to keep their charter. Let me say peace and respect to your favorite couple. Thank you for coming over. Your favorite couple. Check out their channel. They have a YouTube channel as well. Lovely couple. I love the folks. I love everybody that supports the channel. And if people have channels, I have no problem with people dropping the links, the mods, dropping links to people that have channels. This is about supporting all of us, supporting each other. Super Mike, I think you have a channel. Let everybody know where they can find you too.
I'm sorry. I was on mute. Super Mike 2164 channel. You type that in, it should come up. And I'll drop a link too.
Okay. And you know what I know? Yeah. If you're a mod and you have a channel, I don't have a problem with you dropping the link. Just make sure y'all drop that info media link. You got to get over there. I should have, by the time I end this stream, I should have at least 200 close to 200 subs on that channel now. Come on, folks. I'm giving some good information over there, especially if you are a content creator or you want to start a YouTube channel. I know there's other people on YouTube who talk about this stuff, but I'm going to give it to you from a whole different perspective. So please check out that channel. I got two videos that I dropped. I'm dropping a new video tomorrow. I'm going to go deep and deep. Most of that content is so searchable. I looked at my analytics and I think that eventually if I keep doing what I'm doing, that channel is going to take off. But I'm going to give you updates what's happening with YouTube right now. And I told you in the last video that if you got 50 subscribers, you can now go live with your cell phone. If you got 1,000 subscribers, you can now they have a system now where you can report people for copyright infringement on your content easier with 1,000 subscribers. And if you have 500 subscribers now, you can now have a community tab versus having 1,000 subscribers to have a community tab. So YouTube's making changes. I got another video coming because I'm not going to give it away. You're going to have to subscribe to the channel and get the information because I'm going to be talking to you about things that are coming up with YouTube. I'm monitoring everything, folks. I'm monitoring YouTube's information. I'm monitoring other YouTubers who talk about this. I'm monitoring, and then I'm going to bring you the point of view from the style that I bring it to you. And that's telling you the truth. I'm not going to give you this buttery crap. So subscribe to that channel. Check out Your Favorite Couple. And check out SuperMike2164 in the chat as well. And TW, thank you for coming over. TW says this: the lesson to Black Town, do not vote in white mayor with an all-white administration. The problem starts there. What were they thinking? We all in a war. Well, brother, I don't think that it was because these black folks voted a white mayor in. What I was saying earlier is at one point in time, you know how this works. You have a white town, black people come in, and then white people do an exodus. They leave, and then it's all black. You can look up in hell. I'll give y'all a little history. Super Mike, you're in California like me. Do you know this, brother? Do you know that South Central LA used to be made up of Germans and Croatians and Europeans in the beginning? Mm-hmm. And then when black people start moving to LA from the South into parts of what we call Crenshaw and South Central LA, that the white people, the Europeans that were there, they left the community. They got scared. They got angry that black people come moving in, and they left.
Yes.
And that the reason why you have street gangs in Los Angeles was because there were white street gangs first in South. See, people don't know this history. There were white street gangs in South Central LA before there were black street gangs. And there was a white street gang that wore a jacket where they had a noose on the back of their jacket with us hanging. And then there was a group of black men before the Crips and the Bloods. There was a group of black men in the community that were saying that they were being harassed in school by the white gangs when black people were moving into Los Angeles from the South. And what happened? The black students formed a unitedness amongst each other. And the first gang was called the Celestines. The Celestines. Dang. There's a documentary you got to see, folks, called The Bastards of the Party. It's showing you the history of the gang structure in Los Angeles. It was the Celestines, older brothers, who started first. And then it morphed into the Crips because the Crips were trying to emulate what group, Super Mike? What group that we're very aware of that was founded in Oakland? Who were they trying to
Black emulate? Panthers.
The Black Panther Party. The Crips originally will wear leather jackets and berets. Mm-hmm. And then, unfortunately, as things have changed, it morphed into something else eventually.
What's that documentary again? Say that again.
It's called the Bastards of the Party. The Bastards of the Party. It's about I hope I'm saying it right. I think it's called the Bastards to the Party. Basically, it's a documentary documenting the gang structure in Los Angeles, how it got started, how the Crips and the Bloods split from each other, how they were banging on each other, how it all started, and how you had white gangs in South Central LA that were messing with black people. And when black people moved there, it was European immigrants that lived there that were trying to mess with black folks. And then they eventually moved out of South Central LA. Well, that's what happens with a town like Mason, Tennessee. In Tennessee,
That's deep.
It is deep.
I found it. I'm about to put it in the chat, folks.
Thank you. Yeah, thank you. Everybody and their mama needs to see that documentary. And one of the brothers that's in that documentary, he's an actor. He's been in, I think he was in Training Day. He's a blood. He gives you a blow-by-blow of what was happening. They talk about it, how they split. What was the factions? How the neighborhoods were split up? How the police were messing
see,
with
that's
them.
Our history. See, this is...
That's our history. That's right.
Hey, and, man, see, this
and,
is...
and another thing that I... Another thing that I want to talk about is there was already documents that came out about how the police were spying and harassing Nipsey Hussle purposely. I have yet to talk about that one. Oh, yeah.
Wow.
They got, yeah, Lion's Den, they have documents that the LAPD had a probe on Nipsey Hussle and his crew harassing them over and over again. When they were trying to build their business.
You see, and the thing is, see, what we don't, a lot of us, if we, see, like, by going over our history sometimes, and especially in different areas of the country, we start seeing their patterns because really with this thing in Mason, it's like, it's literally the same, similar situation as they did in Detroit, like,
right.
With Kwame Kilpatrick, because people don't realize, too, that Detroit had loaned the state of Michigan, like $250 million or something.
Right.
And they hadn't paid it back. And then they start getting on when they wanted to, you know, take out the mayor, Kilpatrick, because he had actually balanced the budget, you know, which hadn't been balanced in like 40 years. Right. And he started building on, you know, in the city and all this kind of stuff. And they wanted to take him out. And he made a mistake and stupid, but, you know, they took him out. And it's the same pattern.
Let's bring up this one. So we might... Lion's Den, you lived in D.C., so you know this best. Marion Barry was beloved by black people in the D.C., Maryland area because he did a lot for people, for people's mothers and fathers, people who were youth. He brought jobs and stability economically to the community, and he was pro-black. When you talk about, people like to make fun of the term pro-black. Pro-black means doing for black people economically. Marion Barry, say what you will about his drug problems, he was doing too much stuff for black people. And the powers that be didn't like that. So they set him up. They knew he had a drug problem. So they said, let's use the vice against him. So when he got caught in the hotel with the prostitute or whoever the woman he was messing with and they was getting high, they tried to discredit Marion Barry, not because he was doing stuff for black people. That's why he got discredited. They had to discredit him on his drug use, right? But then people kept saying, why are black people keep voting him back into office? Because Marion Barry was a writer for black people. Marion Barry did things for the black community. Anytime you have a black mayor who is doing things for the black community, he will be shunned away. I give you this history. Super Mike, you remember this. This is going to take you way back. Mm-hmm. Willie Brown, when Willie Brown became mayor of San Francisco and the 49ers wanted to build a stadium, the goal was to build a stadium at Candlestick Park, which is an area near Betrayal Hill Projects, an area that was in very bad shape, a very poor, economically poor black community that was right next to that park, that Candlestick Park. Willie Brown's proposal was to build a mall connected to the stadium because he was thinking about bringing jobs and economic boom to the community. Guess what happened in San Francisco? I remember this very well. The Board of Supervisors, made up of people who have a certain colored flag, I gotta be honest,
right,
who get all the perks in San Francisco. I grew up seeing this there. They get all the perks. Anything they want, they get. When black people want something, we get nothing.
No.
In San Francisco, Willie Brown's proposal was shunned and shut down by these groups because it was a proposal that would benefit black people in a poor community near the Betrayal Hill area where you had housing project areas. And that's why that stadium never got built there, and it's in Santa Clara to this very day. Not many people know or remember that history unless you're old enough to remember it. I lived through that history. See once
another
again,
thing.
Go ahead, brother.
No. I was just saying, this is, I mean, like you said, this is like straight up all around the country, but I just want us to think about this too. Like, because we know this history, we know where it's going.
Right. King Waves so, knows. Like, he said Hunter's Point. He knows the history.
Yep. Hunter's Point. I just started learning about it because actually I just came to Chicago, to California. So I'm not familiar with what you just said because I just came here. But like I said, I'm hearing similar tones because to me, it's like they meet somewhere. They had like their little country clubs or their little clan meetings or something. And they'd be like, oh, this is how we going to get them. You know, because they do the same thing everywhere.
Right. Hey, Robin, I got you. You say it's over 68% black as of 2010. Explain what you mean by that. Is that a town? Is that a city? I probably missed what you said in the chat room. Super Mike says this. The FBI has infiltrated us for years. Yeah, that's a fact. That's a fact, brother. That's a
fact. Tell the
truth. Let me see. Robin said, Mumpower says he's going to take Mason, Tennessee over on Thursday. Oh, I'm going to keep, ladies and gentlemen, I'm going to keep an eye on this. And if I'm able to go live again, jump on this issue again, I will. And if I can go live on Thursday after I find out what happens, I'll go live on Thursday and give you a surprise show. Either way, I'm going to talk about this again. If this is what's really going down, King Wage is aware of this. Brother O'Shea says, a bastard of the party. Yeah, bastard of the party. Yes. Bastard of the, everybody, you need to watch that. If you want to understand how the gang structures got created in California, and Super Mike, this is another history again in Lion's Den. There was an area in Los Angeles.
Are you muted? Did you hit mute by mistake?
No. Can you hear me?
Can you hear me?
Oh, hold on. I'm sorry. That's probably me.
It's you. It's you, brother. Okay. All right, Lions, then I'm going to have you chime in on this, too. There was a history in Los Angeles, ladies and gentlemen, where there was an area in Los Angeles that was a bumping, jumping area where you had clubs and nightlife that black people were playing music and jazz, and most of white society in Los Angeles would go into that community because that's where it was all hot. Well, the police in LA would go into that area and purposely attack black people in an area that was booming economically for black people in the clubs and everything else. They try to get black people out of the area. Another reason why the Los Angeles police has been so infamous against black people is because this is what happened. When black people migrated from the South to Los Angeles to the West, a lot of the police in Los Angeles were recruited from the South. They were the same Jim Crow police in the South who were recruited up to Los Angeles. And that's one of the reasons why the Los Angeles LAPD has the infamousness that they have, because a lot of their history was that they came up from the South and joined the police department. That's part of the history. And you'll see that in the Bastards of the Party documentary. So watch it.
Mm.
Super Mike, you got some back sound coming in, brother.
Oh, I do?
Some
I'm sorry.
Kind of, got your television and everything in the back sound playing there. Lions, then, you have anything you want to add before I end the stream, brother?
Yes, sir. And what Robin said is correct, that Mumpower is planning to take over the town of Mason by Thursday morning. So that's been, okay. There's been breaking news that's confirmed. It's confirmed that, yes, they will take over on Thursday morning.
Okay, Lions, then, make sure that you, and Lions, then, let everybody know about your channel where they can find you, because I know that you probably will be able, you may be able to report on it before I am, because I won't be back until the evening time, West Coast time. But let everybody know where they can find your channel, because you'll probably break whatever happens way before I do. Go ahead, Lions. Then let everybody know where they can find you.
Okay. I'm going to be on Clubhouse tomorrow morning. So I'm going to be hosting a Clubhouse theme event, talk about the situation in Mason. So you guys can check us out there. You can follow me on my Twitter at The Real Lions Den. You can also follow me on Facebook at Lions Den, a.k.a. Trey X. Also, you can follow me on my Instagram at Lions, at the_real_lions _den2. And you could also Snapchat me at Lions Den 39.
Okay. Lions Den, send me, I'm on Clubhouse. I'll just turn my Clubhouse on. I'm logged out of it, but I'm going to log into it. Send me an invite so I can join your discussion, because I have time tomorrow to join. So just send me an invite or I'll look for you either way. I want to join that discussion if I can, brother, or at least listen in on the discussion. All right.
I got you.
I'll just turn my, I don't have my Clubhouse turned on right now. I'm going to turn it. I don't go on there that much, but I'm going to turn it on specifically so that I can be able to connect with you on the program. And, Miss Davis, thank you for coming over. Thank you. Thank you for coming over. We got Hawk in the house. Incredible Hawk is in the house and I'm going to watch the documentary tonight. Thank you. I hope that I gave y'all some valuable information. That's what it's about, getting that information out there, sharing with everybody so that we can all learn. It's about learning and being aware. What I got to do now is I got to play daddy now. It's time for me to get in the kitchen and get the food ready for the young one. But let me do this. Super Mike, give us your last thoughts, and then I'll go to Lion's Den. Give us your last thoughts or your thoughts about your great thoughts about this whole situation around Mason.
Well, yeah, I just want Lion's Den to go ahead and maybe clue us in. I'm going to try to follow you over there on Twitter and maybe send that link to info so he can get us listening into that Clubhouse conversation that y'all have. Because, you know, we want to make sure we connect with each other, like you said. You know, I think I had a news clip where he actually, Mumpower and them, they actually were supposed to take over the town, I think, last week.
Yes.
So they're being delayed because of us.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
And that's the reason why I said, like, you know, we need to understand that this stuff is not just, you know, they have never had resistance in a lot of the stuff that they do. So. You know, we just need to keep it up. That's it.
All right. Thank you. Lion's Den, what I want you to... Hey, thank you. So, oh, Lion's Den, you dropped off. Where you go? I wanted him to drop any information in the chat room because he's modded up. So, Lion's Den, if you can, you can drop any links to your Clubhouse and anything like that in the chat room, brother. I wish you wouldn't have dropped off. Maybe he dropped off without realizing. We've got O'Reliable who's dropping off here. Thank you, O'Reliable, for coming over today. And let me see. Angelica says, what's his Clubhouse handle? I think it's Lion's Den Trey. I wish he would come back so that he can tell everybody. I'll find him. You know what I'll do, everybody? I'll drop it in the community tab. So those of you who follow the channel, I'll put it in the community tab and give you his name. I'll use my phone and I'll take a picture clip of his Clubhouse profile. And then I'll put it in the community tab tonight and even tomorrow again. And then you all can follow him there. So look into the community tab, look out for that and you'll see. And then I'll probably send it to my Twitter. Cause when you're on a Clubhouse, you can send the Clubhouse to your Twitter to get more people to come over. So my Twitter, as you already know, is Information Man Show, Clinton06. You can go over there and I'll put it on my Twitter as well. If you want to come over and join the discussion, I think that'd be great. Super Mike, thank you for being here though, brother.
Yes, sir. Thank you. And go ahead, be a daddy, just like Back to Basics says.
Yeah.
You know, that's one of our biggest jobs.
Right.
And I appreciate you, big bro.
Yeah, I appreciate you too. Keep doing your thing. And let me just say this. I know people don't like to hear this. The arguing and the nonsense that goes on YouTube where we got black men and black women against each other, it's irrelevant. Our bigger battle is outside in the community where we have big municipalities and states trying to take something from us. That's what we should be talking about and fighting over, not fighting with each other. That's what makes it ridiculous. We got bigger fish to fry. Okay, cool. Lion's Den has come back and he's dropped the Clubhouse information in the chat room. Thank you, Lion's Den, for doing that.
I'm gonna head down, brother, while you close your show out. Appreciate you. Peace.
Appreciate y'all too. Peace to you. Peace to you and clap to you. Okay, cool. So he's in there. Make sure you all subscribe to the Info Media channel, especially if you plan at any time to be a content creator or anything like that. Make sure that you subscribe to that channel.
I want to thank everybody for being here. I want to thank everybody in the chat room for watching. We had a lot of people that came over. Thank you, Lion's Den. Thank you, Red Squad X. Back to the Basic. Angelica, you put some gems out there. Jack A, thank you for being here. Brother Keith, you super chatted me quite a bit today, and I really appreciate that. Boo super chatted me, and I appreciate that. I appreciate everybody who has shown me a lot of love. I really appreciate that, everybody. Old Reliable, TW, the Incredible Hawk came in the house. Jay, the info mate came in and gave me some information. O'Shea, everybody that's come over, I really appreciate the love. Peggy Roster, the info mate, that's an interesting name. Information Man, he says, have you heard of the book Race, Place, and Suburban Policies by Boyd? I got to check it out. I'll have to check it out. That sounds like a good book there. Thanks, Super Mike, for coming over. I want to thank Tiffany Jackson for coming in the house and supporting the show today. Everybody that's came over and those people that are left, Trap Vision, just everybody. I think some people have left. Some people have stuck around. Thank you all again. Let me go down the list here. We got Natural. Oh, Black Anonymous. Thank you for coming over. Black Anonymous, I appreciate that. And Yalfi, if you're out there listening, I'll be in contact with you. I know you want to do some advertisement on the channel, so I'll be in contact with you by email. We got the great, and I mean the great, King Wage. Check his channel out as well. King Wage, thank you for your support today, brother. And you know what things I was, you know what I was talking about. You from the Bay Area too. You know what I was talking about the Petrel Hill area. You got West Oakland, East Oakland. You got Richmond, Vallejo. You got all these spots. You know how things go down in these communities. I appreciate you coming over and being a part of the stream today. And Black Anonymous, thank you for coming over and giving support as always. Do me the biggest favor again, folks, please share the video on all of your social media, Facebook, Twitter, whatever you have, please share it. That's how the channel grows. That's how the video will get more views. I know that I'm not doing a lot of content that's stuff that's exciting, such as stuff like celebrity stuff and all that kind of stuff a lot, like some people do, that brings a lot of views and all that kind of stuff. I haven't done anything on Umar Johnson, who seems not to be able to get the HVAC. It's kind of funny how Umar Johnson has still not gotten the HVAC. It's crazy. But I'll be back with more content. You all take care of yourself out there. And you make this channel go. You make it go where it is. Everybody, check out Nappy Yankees channel. Check out all the great content creators that are out there on YouTube. I'm going to recommend this. Check out people that are giving you relevant information. People that are giving you information that empowers you, that helps you. There's nothing wrong with commentary on what's going on with people like Messy Jesse. You know, we got to be informed on stuff like that too as well, ladies and gentlemen. But I really appreciate that. And so let's get out of here. Let's pick a nice tune and get out of here. I appreciate that again. Let's do it again. Yeah, let's do that one. Yeah.
Tell the truth.
Peace, everybody. All right, Brother Keith. Tim Black is a great channel. Yeah, Tim Black's a great channel. Shout out to Brother Tim Black out there. Peace to him. Check him out. And BS3 Network. Check out the BS3. Check out BS3 Network. You can find it on Facebook. You can find it on Roku TV. I'm on there on Sundays. Supposed to be on at 2 o'clock. Sometimes I come on a little late. Because, you know, it's a real... It takes me a while to get stuff cranking over here. But, I want to thank the BS3 family. Peace to you. Thank you.
Information is power.
And a clap to the BS3 family. Brother Ben, thank you. I'm going to get on out of here. Natural, everybody. Robin, thank you for coming over. TW, Lion's Den, get in contact with me, brother. We got to do some shows together, man. Some commentary. Trish is just coming in the house right there. What's going on? Thank you for coming in. Yalfi, I was just speaking about you. I know we send some emails between each other. I'm going to send you another email so that we can talk. I think you gave me your number so we can talk on the phone and see how we can set it up so we can get a video that I can play on this channel to promote your goods and services. Natural, I need you to do this for me. I need you to also create a ad. So if you want to run an ad on the channel as well to promote what you're doing as well, I'm down with that. And I can also run these things on the other channels that I have as well. So we're going to spread the word for the wealth around here. Thank you again. Take care, everybody.
Tell the truth.
You're my mirror. me my cake and eat it too. But a little time will be enough for me to prove that baby, you're the remedy. You're my mirror.
Tell the truth.
Everybody, enjoy the rest of your weekend, and don't forget to subscribe to the Info Media Live channel, capital letters, all letters capital. If you have an interest in content creation, you will get a lot of information on that channel. You will learn a lot. If you're just curious, you will still learn a lot. So please check out the Info Media Live content channel. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Everybody in the chat room is incredible. Everyone that listened was incredible. Appreciate it. I do this once a week on this channel, and it gives me nothing but pleasure to be able to share information with you that can empower us. Of course, you always have to do things on the street in your individual community. If you don't like what's going on, join an organization, join with people of like-mindedness to change what you don't like that is happening in the world around you or your community. That's how we fight against all of this. It's what we do. We bring awareness, and then we must do what we can in our individual communities collectively to fight off and stop things that are not right. Take care, ladies and gentlemen.